then I'll be like, hey, it's me, it's Juan. Got a podcast. It's Juan time. Basically, like the theme song.
There it is, the Juan time podcast theme song.
I want something to strive for. I want to give a damn. Know my mind can be proud of the man that I am. Oh, take my hand.
This is a dope little spot right here. Oh, I love it.
Oh, wow. All the sounds are cued in now.
Yeah, I think we're sitting good. Guys, welcome to this Juan time.
Oh, we're on right now?
We're always on.
We've been on.
Shout out to Josiah.
Halfway over.
What do you call your studio here?
There is no name.
There is no name studios.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one.
Don't ask us where it is.
There is no name. All one word.
Underscores. No, there's underscores.
At. That's the Instagram handle.
Oh shit. Yeah,
you got to put the at symbol before.
The at's at the end, though.
The long wait.
One. For that one, yeah.
Yeah.
Ooh, the at's at the end. I kind of like that. Guys, today I am joined by Leander and Alexander.
Oh, wow. Snap.
Yeah, a couple of Anders over here. Oh, my God.
We meandered.
It rhymes. We never even knew. What is that? Oh, my hat?
Yeah.
Nah, I don't need that.
No?
Not right now.
No do-rags?
My hair, I think, is looking good.
Hair is looking fly.
Is it?
I don't know. Tropolis got the long locks.
True.
Josiah's got some locks himself. We're going to bring on here in a little bit and ask him some questions about his lovely studio here. Thanks again for hosting. Hosting. He's hosting me, hosting you guys.
Oh, these headphones are so good, I couldn't even hear Josiah say what he just said, and he's only like 10 feet away.
Isolation. Sponsored by Shure. No, not really. guys, thanks for coming on.
Thanks for having us.
I reached out like a week ago, and you guys were like, yeah, whenever. Yeah.
Yeah, dude, thank you very much. It means a lot, Juan.
I know you guys are a little antsy to play a little bit. Do we want to start off with an acoustic song and then kind of like
start right away?
I don't know.
We're going to do like a couple, so like we're really, you know. How long are we?
I'm on your time. We're on Josiah's time. You booked the studio, so hey. he don't care. Look at him over there. He's charging you by the second. He has secondly rates, not hourly rates.
Well, a secondly rate would be pretty good if it broke down, you know? Yeah.
Imagine splitting hairs over a few seconds in the contract.
Yeah. It'd be like, you know, still be very...
You just got to talk fast in between the tracking.
That's right.
Know? Like, okay, cut out that end part, and then we're going to go back to this part right after the snare, and then I'm going to come in and like, 1, 2, 3, 4, let's go.
Yeah. Almost like
that's how you pull it off.
Like an
auctioneer.
For real, yeah.
Let's say a bidder. Yeah, bidders are silent. So you guys have is it an acoustic duo, trio? What are we working with here?
No, we have a band.
And actually, get up on that mic though.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Bring it to you.
Ooh, we have a band here. Actually, it's we're called the Metropolis Man.
Okay.
And we're sitting in the studio where we've been recording this album here with Josiah, and you know, Lee's playing lead guitar over here. And we've got a pretty kick-ass bass player, pretty kick-ass drummer.
Nice.
We are looking to potentially fill the final roster with a couple of horns here. But, yeah, we're playing shows and, you know, just trying to build the base of what we got so far.
You guys want actual horn players, or you wouldn't settle for, like, a guy with a synthesizer and his suspenders?
It'd have to be some really good suspenders.
With the gold latches, right?
Real horns is ideal.
Real horns is a game changer.
That fat sound, yeah.
Game changer.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
And if we can find like a real horn duo that also owns suspenders, then I think that's the golden ticket, right?
They're not mutually exclusive.
Right, yeah.
I'm sure there's plenty of guys left over from, like, the ska times, you know, that have their suspenders and play a horn instrument, you know?
What's that meme I saw where it's like, ska reminds me, or... Yeah, ska is what a 12-year-old kid hears when he gets extra mozzarella sticks at Applebee's or something like that. Like, that's what he hears in his head. I love a horn section. It's another level.
Yeah.
No, it really is. Like, there's something, I'm not going to say primal, but it's just, you're fucking blowing into a piece of metal, dude. Like, and it makes beautiful sounds.
Yeah, you're almost like singing in a way, you know, you know, because you're using your own.
Plus, I think it's like just less common to see than like a guitar and stuff like that. You know, when you start to get these like other instruments in there, I think it can really set you apart.
Yeah.
You know?
And I think you appreciate it more because, I mean, I think you don't actively think about it, but subconsciously you're like, that's a loud instrument. It's hard to master. They're expensive. The maintenance is like ungodly, I'm sure. Like, yeah. So to find somebody that like stuck through it with it, and you know, then all of a sudden they're like, "Yeah, I'll be in your band." You're like, "Score!"
Yeah, it's one of those instruments where it's like, "Oh yeah, I used to play saxophone when I was a kid or something like that."
Yeah,
it's like ah.
But Bill Clinton made the saxophone sexy.
Just call up old Bill and see if he can get him in our band.
Dude, imagine. That'd be tight. He'd probably have a huge draw.
Yeah.
I wonder if he can still blow it.
Hey, hey.
Is that what they call it? Is that the term for it?
I think so. Pretty much.
You
that's what you're doing.
Pucker up and blow.
I wonder if he could still pucker the old lips. Those old Clinton lips.
Not for Hillary.
Maybe for Monica though.
Ooh.
Oh dang.
Oh, is that too soon still?
No.
No way, dude. What year is this? Too soon. Because like a few presidents ago now.
Leander.
What's up?
You're recently back from Jersey.
That's true.
How was your time back? How long were you gone? Was it like 3 years?
Yeah, like pretty much like 3 years, yeah.
God,
I came back in like October 2017, I guess, you know.
And you've been back since October?
I think that's when I went back to Jersey.
Oh,
it was like
October 2017.
Yeah. Gotcha. And then I was there, yeah, for a good few years, dude. And I just came back like 2 months ago.
Yeah, I was going to say, there's no way you've been back since October.
Yeah, no way. No, it's definitely been a journey, dude, you know?
Yeah.
Jumping back and forth, a lot of moving around.
You're from Jersey?
Yeah, originally, yeah.
So a lot of your family is still back there?
Yeah, for sure.
Nice. So, when you moved to AZ when we met, how long were you here? It's only like 2 years, right?
Yeah, so I came out here to go to school, at Roberto Van, the Lutheran school, you know,
that's
I went
right.
there for 6 months, mm-hmm. and then I went back to Jersey again. That's where I got the job at Guitar Center, everything, you know. Then I get, that's when I moved to Mesa, you know, like I transferred to the Mesa store.
Yeah.
That's where I met you guys, everybody, Mesa, classic stuff, you know. So I stayed at the Mesa store for like 13 months, you know. So by that point, like in total, I had lived in AZ for like a year and a half, you know.
Yeah.
And then I went back to Jersey again, and now I'm here again.
So this is your
We're
third
keeping
stint.
Keeping it going. Yeah. This is the third stint, yeah.
So what called you to Jersey, and then what called you back to AZ?
So at that time, when I was leaving Mesa, you know, to go back to Jersey, it was just like there were more opportunities there at the time,
mm-hmm.
you know? Obviously I'm from there, you know? I know a lot of people that are from there, and so like... That's where I had more sort of connections and stuff. And so I went back there and I joined this cover band.
Mm-hmm.
And that area was the perfect place to be playing in a cover band.
Nice.
You know? Because we got the whole Jersey Shore, which is like, you know, has a popping music scene like in the summertime, you know?
Yeah.
And then we got New York City, which is right there. We got Philadelphia, you know? So we would travel around. And like, you know, musically, I think it was a really good thing to do because I made a lot of progress. Just like sort of in my professional music career, being back in Jersey. But after COVID hit, it's like everything shut down. It got all crazy over there.
Oh,
all the opportunities just dried up, you know?
Nothing.
Yeah. So it was like, you know, Arizona was a place where like, even if I didn't have the opportunities that I have, you know? It's like if everything that you have was suddenly ripped away from you,
yeah,
where do you want to be? What do you want to be doing, you know? Yeah. And I was like, well, I'd rather be like out in the desert, like hiking around and stuff, you know?
Yeah.
So I feel like it's like a good a time as any to make that transition, you know? And so that's why I came back to Arizona again.
For the great outdoors.
Yeah, no doubt, dude. Been doing a lot of hike. I mean, it's hot now, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
But I did a night hike last night, you know?
Yeah? Gotta watch out for them rattlers.
I know, I was looking. I got like a super bright flashlight, you know? So I was definitely like...
This guy and his snakes, man. It's not even funny.
What do you mean?
I like snakes.
So what do? You come across one and you're just like, what's
up? No, he's like, he'll like look it straight in the face and like be like, hey, you want to be my friend? And the snake's like, no, get the F out of here.
Sometimes. Other times they're like, yeah, we can be friends.
No,
it's all
not,
good.
Dude. When has it ever been like we can be friends?
So when I first came out here and I'm staying in Mesa at Airbnb in like East Mesa.
Oh, that tiny little snake. Yeah, of course.
There was a little gopher snake. Yeah, it was like in a tree.
Yeah.
And... yeah, just like picked him up out of the tree, you know, and he was like calm and cool the whole time. Even when like when I put him down and let him go, he was just like, all right, I'm out of here. Good times, you know. He wasn't like dipping away real quick or anything.
Yeah, he was chill. He's strolling. He's like,
I feel like he sensed that I was like, you know, I wasn't like attacking him. I was just like, dude, let's hang out for a minute, you know, and he was like, cool, cool. Let's do it.
Damn, snake whisperer, huh?
So we were on the trail the other day and... there's like this giant rattler snake like off to the right there, like right as we're walking by. And I see it on my peripheral. I'm in front of him, and I'm just like, nope. I'm just gonna keep looking ahead. And Lee's like, and Lee sees it. And he's like, oh hey, look at you, bud.
Does it get down on his belly and slither up to him?
Just about. I was checking out the old body language there. Yeah. He was cool. He was cool. He wasn't like he wasn't getting angry or anything.
Well, you would notice as soon as he coils up, right?
Yeah, for sure. You know. Or if they, like, if they stare at you too long, you know, or if they kind of move towards you. Like, I don't like that. If he's moving towards me, then I should be, I feel like I should be backing away,
ooh,
you know.
He's licking the air.
I've never seen them move towards somebody in person or myself.
I had a,
that'd be so fucked.
I had a rattlesnake, like, coming at me one time, for sure, you know.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I mean, not fast. It wasn't like a strike, you know?
But even
but it was
like
very slowly, like he's just moving at me, you know?
Yeah.
Where was that?
And I was like, oh, shit. It was at South Mountain.
Fuck, we're never going there again.
It was totally like the Mormon Trail when I was doing the...
It's all off limits now?
Natural tunnel, yeah. That is, they're out there, man, you know? But...
they're beautiful.
But yeah, you just got... like that. They'll always warn you, you know? They're not going to sneak up on you. They're definitely going to be like, hey, you're getting too close. You know, so like, that's all you can ask for from a dangerous animal. It's yeah. Like, honestly, it's as courteous as any dangerous animal that there is.
Fucking crazy.
Hey, dude, I'm rattling.
Yeah.
Turn around. Now's your chance, you know?
He's almost like saying, hey, psst, out of here. Like, ah.
Yeah, for real.
Yeah.
That's classic, yeah.
So here, you guys are recording... tonight, tomorrow.
Yeah, I don't know if we're gonna do any recording tonight, but yeah.
Okay. But you got some shit in the work. Yeah, yeah. You got shit in the works right now.
Yeah, definitely. Well, we just don't want to keep Josiah up all night here, you know. But yeah, we've been in here for a few months, and we got a long ways to go.
Yeah.
We're like recording a whole album right now, but we'll probably put out like a couple singles and stuff here soon. Doing a lot of like the guitar and vocals and softer stuff here, and then we'll go and like record drums and rhythm section stuff at a studio with, you know, a little bit of a better setup, you know.
Yeah,
but Josiah's got it pretty locked down here, man.
No, I love it. Love the feel. It's dope. And there's it's a basement in Arizona. You don't fucking see that shit. Yeah, nah, I dig it.
It's actually a giant house, you know, now that you think about it.
Yeah. A nice big house is good, but too big.
Yeah, Josiah, if you lived here by yourself, it'd be pretty scary, huh?
Yeah.
That'd be too spooky.
What's that sound? So writing some an album.
Yeah, yeah.
Are you guys both like bringing like lyrics to the table, or is
it's mainly my project? When I used to play in a band called Captive Cooks,
mm-hmm. You know that. Yep, yep.
Juan supported my band for many years. Thank you. So over the summer, we released an album last year, actually last May, a year ago, called Easy Bake Lovin'.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it was like one of those things where like, well, COVID's here and it's not going away, so we might as well just release this thing.
Mm-hmm.
And like we were set to do this big release show and,
at Last Exit, never right?
Happened. Yeah. At Last Exit Live. And, eventually, you know, the band kind of fizzled out, members moved away, mm-hmm. stuff like that. So, I was, pretty set on at that point, just starting my own solo project type of thing. So,
yeah,
that's when I started coming over here and recording with Josiah and, yeah, basically, so
you've known Josiah for some time now.
Yeah, so our friend Jared Wood introduced us together. He is from the band Panic Baby.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Which you should check out. Those guys are amazing.
Yeah. Maybe I'm confusing them with Playboy Man Baby.
Yeah, I think you are.
Okay. I've seen them.
But
Panic
Baby. Yeah, Panic Baby used to be, what was their old name? The
Real Fits.
The Real Fits. And then they were Panic Baby, and now I think it's just Raquel's doing her own thing now. She's going by the name Rocky Collins.
Okay, I like it.
I think Josiah's also helping her out with that, too. Yeah, he's got his hand in everything.
Yeah, like that, man.
They moved out to Asheville, one of the Carolinas. North Carolina.
North.
Yeah. So that's where they're making music now, but... Yeah, Jared hooked me up with Josiah and kind of took off from there, yeah.
How much convincing did Lee take before he was on board?
Not very much at all. I was texting him, you know, he was told me he was coming back out here or whatever. And, you know, we were like, yeah, sweet dude, you know, like we're going on a ton of hikes and type of stuff. And then at the same time, I was like trying to put together my band here. And... I like needed a sweet guitarist / keyboard player, and I was like, oh shit, like Lee totally does that. He's totally like a badass guitarist and keyboard player,
a virtuoso.
He's like a badass everything. So I was like, dude, you want to just like come play in my band? He was like, yeah, of course, you know.
Yeah, it actually worked out great, because like I was playing in a band in Jersey, you know.
Yeah.
And so like all that had just like come to a halt with like the shutdown and everything, you know. So leaving there and coming here, like I had to like tell that band, you know, like if things really come back, like I'm going to be gone.
You know?
Like I had to leave the band, you know? So to leave that and to like have an opportunity just like right there already, like waiting for me lined up was like the most perfect, like seamless thing, you know? Like, yeah, that's great, because like otherwise I would have had to like, I don't know, you know, I would have definitely had to look for a band. Like, who knows how long that would take, or if I was going to start one, like how long that takes to sort of build.
Yeah, and to find like the right characters and people you mesh with, like you guys already had a friendship.
And yeah, like I didn't really know anybody yet, like that many other people coming out here, you know. It was just like you guys and like a couple other people, Max, like, you know. Actually, that would be a dope band if all four of us started a band.
It would be pretty sweet. Yeah. The last time we were on this podcast, me and Max tried to convince Juan to play in a cover band with us, actually.
Oh, dude. Whenever the cover band, time. I mean, like...
They're fun.
There's, you know, there really is a place for it, you know?
Oh, yeah.
It was a really great experience, you know, definitely playing with it. Like, learning things, like, professionally, but also just, like, so much fun, you know?
Yeah. A
lot of opportunity for having good times, you know?
Yeah, there's a place for everything. There's a place for, you know, you... writing your original stuff and performing it, where you're bringing your own creations to light. But then there's also something to be said about, like, you know, people go out to have a good time and they want to hear some stuff that they're familiar with.
Yeah, no doubt.
And if you can create that nice vibe and, you know, something for them to have a good night.
It's a great feeling too, to be playing songs that people like chime in and sing along to, and like they want to participate, because as an original artist, unless you get to a certain level, people just aren't going to know your songs.
Yeah.
Because totally. That's just like the way it is. They got to hear them first, you know? They got to hear them a few times.
from like the early stages of being an artist to like the later stage of being an artist is like the earlier you are, the more covers you got to play. And then like the more established you get, the less covers you're allowed to play, you know, because people know your music.
Oh, hey.
True.
And then you have to play a bunch of your original stuff. Like you're from the beginning, you're like, I've grown past that. But
songs
there's like, I want to hear.
Grown, yeah. It's true. But you know what? It's cool. Like there's like two parts of it, you know, like half of it is playing music for yourself, you know, like playing what you want to play, like what's interesting to you to play, you know, and like what's like gratifying, like musically, you know, and then the other half is like playing what the audience wants to hear, you know.
It's a balance.
And like, if you can make it so that they're both the same thing, then it's like more power to you, you know.
That's the goal for everybody.
But every now and again, you're definitely going to be bouncing
those
things, you know.
I think if you always err on the side of, you know, I'm going to play stuff that's original to me, then ultimately I think you're happier. But there is something to be said about the, like the Lady Gaga route, where it's like become this big pop star and then have this cushion. And then you can go and actually do what the fuck you want to do, and you're paid.
Sure. Yeah,
I mean,
it's a little bit of a harder route to go, I would say.
Yeah,
maybe it's easier. Actually.
I don't know.
Yeah,
but it might be easier, dude. Because writing pop songs is like doesn't have to be hard.
Yeah. I mean, there's a formula.
Yeah, no doubt.
It's a formula these days. It really is. But I mean, if it is, it's almost like the argument stuff. If it's that easy, why isn't there like a million pop stars? Right.
Yeah, no doubt.
I don't know. It still takes a personality.
I'm sure it's not like the easiest thing in the world or anything, you know?
I don't think anything is at a certain level.
Yeah.
Like, you can make fucking paper airplanes, but...
Also, I don't know if most pop stars are as, like, talented musically as Lady Gaga. You know?
Yeah, I mean, she went to Juilliard?
Did she?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah,
I don't know. That's pretty cool, actually. I didn't know that.
Yeah, no, I'm pretty sure she went.
I thought she was talented she before you told me that information.
Yeah. Yeah, no, she was legit, for sure. I can't name most of her songs, but I just know that. That's what, like a fun fact. Yeah. But, you know, I've always kind of pondered that myself. It's like, why don't you kind of play the cookie cutter shit that you know is most likely going to hit? And then again, once you're well off and that, if your contract allows, then you can kind of go out and explore and be yourself. But it's like, is that a price that you're willing to pay to put up with, like playing stuff you really is not true to you to in the future? It's like an investment, right?
I think it's just like a matter of like if you want to like risk it and try to play stadiums, or if you're comfortable playing smaller clubs your whole life, you know?
Smaller clubs, more intimate shows.
I think that that there's room for all of it, you know?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, definitely. For me, like I definitely like to play like a range of things, and I like to sort of write a lot of different types of music, you know?
Yeah.
And like create different genres of music and stuff. Like I don't like to like put myself in a box like as a musician.
Yeah.
But when I was younger, I feel that I did do that, you know? Like I was more like, I only played like, I was more like a rocker, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I only played like rock and like heavier types of music, you know? And part of it was that I wanted the music that I was writing to have a certain like level of like complexity to it, you know?
Yeah.
And I still appreciate those things that I was doing at that time, because I feel like that was like that had value to it, you know, like, investing my time into making this like complex music. But at the same time, like as I learned more, I felt like I didn't need to make it so complex. Like not everything needs to be overcomplicated.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And certain things, it's like, exactly, you know, like certain songs are just focused on other things. And songs that are like really very lyrically driven might be overpowered by too much music,
too
you know?
Much, yeah.
So if you have like a really strong like lyrical message, then you don't necessarily need to have like all crazy music stuff happening, you know?
Yeah, it's like a hip hop song or a rap song or something where you get like a good hook. And it's like, okay, give them a taste of the hook and then just let it play out because I got something to say.
Yeah.
You know?
But if you're going to do like an instrumental jam, then you probably don't want it to just be three chords the whole time. Like on a loop.
Yeah.
But also
not just be too, so like technically robotic. Like just all over the place and not have any actual feel.
Yeah, no doubt.
To it. utilization of space, I think, is like the hardest thing
to
kind of master. It's like letting the song breathe, which I think you guys did pretty well on Captive Cooks, man. There's a few songs, you know, especially like Waltz, like you let that song breathe, man.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
Yeah.
We're playing Waltz in this band.
Nice. I mean, that's a good track.
I mean, there's a bunch of songs that, you know, like in that band that, like, you know, I wrote. We'll just play in this band too, you know? Just
because,
like,
we can keep them going, dude. Keep them alive.
Good songs, you know? So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they sound totally different now, you know, with like this new lineup. So, might as well. They're like different songs almost, you know?
We're doing covers too. We're covering Captive Cooks.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Just add it to the cover list.
Covering Captive Cooks, CCC. No, that's CCR. I was like, hold on, you're infringing. You're infringing.
We're not doing any CCR yet.
Not yet, huh?
No.
You're leaving that for the later years?
I wouldn't be opposed to any CCR.
Come on.
They got good stuff. They got classics.
You got to wear a
CCR
camo.
CCR song, would you do, Lee?
Yeah, you got to come out in camo, Son. Dude.
Fortunate Son is classic guitar riff type deal, you know? Bad Moon Rising is really fun. Sing along, super easy tune, like we were talking about before, you know? It's like,
that's just it.
It's one of those ones.
Scooby, dooby, dooby, dooby. That one.
It's like a.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Something like that. There you go, dude.
Yeah, that one.
We basically got it. We got it down.
Yeah, all right.
We should play that this Friday night.
Josiah, hit record. Premiere.
We're pretty much halfway there.
Yeah. That's all it takes. I do miss jamming. I miss jamming out. Because I was jamming out with my hip-hop group that I had like fucking 10 years ago, last like September, but then...
Oh, you did?
Yeah, we were jamming there for a bit, and we had a keyboard player. Ray was playing keys.
Really?
I had an old GC guy playing drums and guitar, and I'm playing bass. But then, just issues with COVID, car accidents, like guys were in.
Ray had a baby, right?
Yeah, Ray had a baby.
Wow. Yeah, isn't that cool, dude?
He's a daddy.
That's crazy.
Daddy Ray.
I've been gone a while though, that's so awesome, you know, man. Everyone's having babies.
You have been gone a minute.
Did you have another baby since he's been gone? You're just popping him out like crazy.
Not that I know of. No, Luis did. Two kidding. And I'm done.
I'm just kidding.
Luis had a baby since I've been gone though.
Oh yeah, he had another one? Or no?
No, but just the one. Just baby. One, yeah. I mean, unless he did, I don't know if he had another one, but definitely one. So Luis and Ray, that's at least two people having babies in these last 3 years.
What's your baby? Your baby's this Taylor right here, right?
Oh, yeah. This is the only... for sure. This is the only baby I got. I have not been popping out new babies in the last few years.
That pull-out game is strong.
Oh, man. No, but I've been giving my love to this Taylor right here.
Yeah.
He's literally, like, he loves it.
Yeah?
Like,
ooh.
A little too much.
I thought it was a sweat spot over there, but I guess that's...
Classic, well, classic this jam.
This isn't made for kids, you know. That's what it is.
This podcast isn't for kids.
No, hell no, dude.
Oh,
that's a relief. Yeah.
Now I can unwind.
I was like, we're walking the tightrope here with these kids.
Where would you say you draw inspiration from lyrically?
Oh, that's a good question. For me, it's like, just like any like life experiences.
That's what I'm going for also, type of thing.
But sometimes that kind of stuff is like external, you know, like my life experiences, like things that I've been through, like obviously are going to contribute to like lyrics that I write because that's easy for me to draw from. But even like other things that like I've seen or just like witnessed in my life, like, has made me reflect on it. I'm like,
do you think it's more like the happier moments, or maybe like scary moments or sad moments?
Try to capture all of them.
You know? Yeah, I mean, for me, it's the ones that like really like just like make you feel like the most, you know?
Right, exactly. So, yes. I was talking about this with someone the other day. Like, that's the whole reason why I want to play like music forever is just to make people feel something, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Whether
yeah,
or not
yeah, that's
like,
the goal, yeah.
Yeah, you know, what the feeling is not really, doesn't really matter as much as it is like moving them, you know?
Yeah, no doubt. So, and it might be different for everybody too, you right, know?
Yeah.
The way they feel when they hear like certain music, I guess. But yeah, definitely like that's the stuff that like makes you feel like the most, I think, is yeah, like that's the important stuff. If it's good or bad, you know.
But do you feel like there's certain, like I always feel like I'm not a fucking good musician by any means, yeah, but like when I like write like or I'm messing around, my songs always tend to go doom 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 doom. Like they never go off, they're never like up and poppy like doo 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 doo.
Oh yeah,
doo.
I know
like
what
my
you
shit's
mean,
always like melancholy, I guess.
Yeah, I definitely know what you mean. I have certain like certain things that I go back to, and sometimes it's like on purpose because like I feel like I've like sort of like cut out my own sound.
Mm-hmm.
Where you know I'm like if you heard a bunch of different guitar players like play over this one thing, I feel like you'd be able to tell me like a part, you know, like everyone will have their own sound, you know.
Yeah.
Like I got like my own like little sound, so sometimes like certain things like I just like intentionally put them into different songs, you know.
Yeah.
Just because it's like this will give it that kind of Lee,
that Lee signature.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, so you know, I mean, I don't want to like too many things to be like really similar, you know. But yeah, definitely there's a couple, like, there's definitely, like, a certain feel to, like, all of my music, I feel like, you know? It's not usually, like, super, like, peppy and happy, though, you know?
Yeah.
It's usually, like, more chill and, like, I would say mellow. It's not, like, sad, but it's, like, definitely
like,
more mellow.
Yeah, not necessarily sad songs. Like, I like...
But sometimes I do,
like tragic country shit, dude.
Yeah.
Fuck, I love that shit.
Sometimes I like to do, like, the really, like, peppy, uplifting, like, funk music, though.
Yeah.
I love, like, fast, like, good funk music, you know?
Some Niles Rogers type of strums. Like,
yeah, for sure.
Like, dead notes.
Yeah, and just, like, good wild. Like, that's happy music, you know? Yeah.
Yeah, I definitely get down on that. That shit does make me move. I think lyrically, though, like, yeah, like, tragic country bluegrass type songs just hit
yeah,
a little bit different for me.
Yeah,
where
no
it's
doubt,
like man, like because I tend
I
to be
like
an
that
upbeat
Benjamin
person.
Todd type
yeah,
yeah,
yeah, dude.
He's solid. Yeah,
yeah, Lost Dog, dude.
No doubt,
it speaks to me.
That's deep stuff, man. I feel you.
Yeah, I think I kind of gravitate towards that just because I tend to be like an upbeat person, like always, you know, good going.
Yeah.
That it's like, you know, that somebody can tap into that sadness or tragedy that they've experienced and like make a beautiful song out of that. Like I think that's what kind of like draws me the most to it.
Yeah. No doubt. I think it's easier for me to write songs about that kind of stuff, like that sort of darker side of things, because it's harder for me to express that stuff in other ways.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
where it's like, you know, if I'm like,
but when
happy
you pour
and peppy,
it to an art, right,
it's easy for me to just be like, yeah, dude, I'm so happy today, yeah, you know? But like, if I'm in a bad mood, I'm way less likely to be like, you guys, this is what's got me down, you know?
Yeah, it's going to put it into a song.
So, yeah, exactly, yeah, you know?
Yeah, pour that into your art.
For sure.
And let it flourish.
Yeah. That's what it's all about, you know?
I like it. You want to rip one or what?
What, like the bong?
No. I need it. As soon as I said it, I was like,
yeah, you let me write it. Is my guitar on here? Can
yeah,
you hear me? Is do I have signal coming right here? Because
yeah,
I can never tell which way my volume knob is. Or oh, is it better like this?
What? Let me go take a look.
Okay. All right.
All right. Brought to you by Juan. Taking a look this one time. Just this one time.
We're taking a look. Taking a look this one time.
What do you see there? Do you see sound waves?
Are there waves coming out of this bad boy here?
I'll just control the gain compression on the back end.
Nice.
I'll just send the WAV files to Rick Rubin and let him go to town on it.
All right, thanks, Rick. Brought to you by Rick.
Oh, All right. So this thing is on or is it not?
Yeah.
You're live. Give it a good pop. You're live, buddy. Ring ding ding.
Yeah, it's coming through.
It is?
Yeah, because you're the bottom one there. It's hard to see from this angle, but you're there.
Ah, music.
Okay. All right.
Classic music.
Well, we'll do one of those country western
doodads
things that you were just talking about there.
Lay it on me thick.
All right, yeah. So this is a song from the album we've been working on. This song's called Thirsty Land.
Story by an elderly wise man. Said the devil's just an angel that God couldn't understand. I saw him long ago in the cold of the night, scared and alone, wandering through the moonlight. But he looked up at me, didn't say a word, but I could tell we were. Stories that I heard. The river's dry now where it used to run. Lord, let this man see why he has come. Been around for all my life, and he'll be here for years too. But the next time he comes passing by, don't let him frighten you. If you can believe in ghosts, would you believe in angels too? And wouldn't you like to see the world through their own point of view? Sometimes we go blind. Hearts and make us love again. If we do, we'll never know what's inside every single breathing man. The truest part about ourselves are most often not the easiest to shine. So if you ever talk, old man. Well, I've got time. Well, I heard there was a woman who came a looking around for me. She was gonna show me where that river used to meet the sea. If I don't find it soon, that man's gonna take my soul. And then I'll have to spend my life doing everything that I'm told. The river's dry now where it used to run. Lord, let this man see why he has come. The reason why is always hard to understand. Won't you let it rain and quench this thirsty land? Take my hand.
Solid, nice. Man.
Thanks, man. All
right, very cool. Yeah, very
that's
cool.
A, that's a good one, yeah.
That was so good, man. That was so good. Yeah, your vocals are on point, man.
Oh, dude, these guitars are on point, man. That's
dude, that solo nice. Kicked in? I was not expecting that.
No, it's hey, thanks, guy.
Yeah. Solid, man.
Yeah, it's
it was
like
always a, fun times. Yeah.
Anytime like the solo section comes around in one of our songs now, it's like, oh, shit. It's Lee time. It's go to work, baby.
Yeah, you remind me of Kalen, the guy in the hip hop group. He's in a bunch of cover bands too.
Yeah.
One of the baddest guitar. You know Kalen.
Kalen nice, from nice, Psychic Elephants? Cool.
Yeah.
Dude.
Oh, snap.
You literally, Gross, right?
Yeah, Gross. Yeah, Gross.
Yeah, yeah, dude. He's a good guy.
Yeah, you literally just point to him and like, hey, dude, go ahead and solo. And he's like, all right. That's you too, man.
That's usually how it goes. Not just with this band, but like, honestly, that's like how I've gotten a lot of different gigs was from, you know, just like being sort of like having developed my skills as like a lead player.
Yeah.
And then people who like write their own music just like need it filled out. And so they're like, do you want to play some leads over this stuff? Oh, like, I've joined, like, a bunch of bands that way.
Yeah, as like a songwriter, like, you write a song, and then, like, and you're like, damn, my soloing skills suck. But then it's like, you come around, and it's like, oh, yeah, I can drop a little, you know, Leander-ness on this. And it's like, yeah, that's exactly what I wish I could do. Like, yeah.
I definitely do my best to, like, help, like, realize somebody's vision. You know, like, if they got, like, a specific part, like, I'm happy to like learn that stuff, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, for the most part, I also like, I did this, like this music program, like when I was really young, that was like a bunch of kids like being put in bands together, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like you learn at that age. Oh, this guy oh, there it doesn't is. Even yeah, silence the
Do you have
phone,
your own
dude.
Song as your ringtone?
I wish.
Oh, I actually do have that, but it's, oh, you couldn't handle it, dude. It's too crazy.
Oh, are you going to show him that one?
When
the Bing Bong sings
yeah,
on?
Show him the Bing Bong song. Yeah.
All right, I'll check it out.
Whip it out. So what's the story behind this Bing Bong sing song?
It's just I was just trying to make a ridiculous thing to be the ringtone, you know, on my phone.
Yeah.
Because, like, when I was young, that was, like, always what I wanted to do. I was like, wouldn't it be so funny if I could, like...
Make your own ringtone?
Yeah, but it would just be something absolutely ridiculous, you know?
Because, like, a big fart
it has
noise,
to be,
like,
you know? Yeah.
Uh-oh.
And now, like, fast forward, dude, we have the technology. It's not that hard. Let's see if I can get this in here. It's my ringtone, dude. That's, I made that myself.
Bing, that bong, is perfect.
It's classic. For me, it's like if you, like, walked into, like, a nightclub, like, in Europe, and, like, everybody's, like, smoking, and they're just like,
yeah.
This is the
pink
best
lasers.
Night of my life.
Yeah.
Pink lasers too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This place is so cool.
So cool.
That should be like the song that's playing.
You should have been here last week when so, I don't know, somebody big was here.
I don't know.
It's
don't
classic.
And I'll lie.
What is that? That's from Letterkenny.
Is it?
That's classic, yeah. Yeah, for sure.
The
LA
what is that called? The Canadian Workaholics? No. What are they? It's described as something like that.
It's similar to the Trailer Park Boys, but yeah, that's also yes.
Canadian.
Wait, it is?
Yeah.
Oh,
you guys,
that's why I'm they're Canadian. So similar, I guess.
What?
I'm also Canadian.
You're not Canadian.
Oh my mom is born in Alberta.
But you're
that
not.
That makes me Canadian.
I'm makes you a snap. Quarter.
Okay, yeah.
Well, he's right.
A quarter commie. anything outside of the
we're not the good kind of Canadian anyways, like we don't make poutine or like any of the good stuff, like,
no,
they make like tomato ass picky for Thanksgiving.
What's ass picky? It sounds
I'll tell you why.
That's a thing.
It's a tomato like jelly.
A tomato
why do they have
jelly?
To call it that?
And there's like shrimp and like cucumbers and like
wait,
celery
it's
it.
Just it's
whose a, idea was it to
that's
call it
some stupid
picky.
Canadian
no that's frozen yeah. That's frozen ceviche. It's a frozen shrimp cocktail.
Well, in Canada they call it ass picky,
so they basically just add gelatin instead of it just being tomato juice. Yeah, it actually Canada. Sounds delicious now.
Oh, that's crazy.
God, man, Jesus,
it's
that
literally
name,
that's what
that name
is.
Is too silly.
Have you had well yeah oh for sure dude.
Yeah,
especially coming from ceviche.
Yeah, see that's like that doesn't sound silly to me at all.
No.
Sounds ass picky.
Canada, they're like ceviche.
Maybe in
maybe
maybe in Quebec. In Quebec.
I don't know. But I don't know nothing. I can't eat any of that stuff. I can't eat shrimp.
Why? What's going on? Yeah, shellfish.
I'm allergic to shellfish. Yeah.
So what does that all encapsulate?
All right, check this out.
Okay.
This is not everybody knows this.
No, okay. No, that's why I want to know. Cockroaches. Yeah, it's part of it.
It's. I mean, honestly, it might be, but definitely, you know, shrimp and crab, lobster, that kind of stuff. And then like squid and octopus is the thing that like people don't really realize, but
that's
like,
part of it too.
Yeah, like cephalopods.
Cephalopods
are technically mollusks. Mollusks are shellfish, you know, and so obviously like a snail is a shellfish, you know.
Yeah.
But like same thing with the, because like they're animals that like have evolved like from having shells. You
yeah.
know?
Well, it's so the same it's, like, thing.
They're like, in the same category.
Yeah, like on Fear Factor, they didn't realize that you couldn't eat cockroaches if you had a shellfish allergy because they're. Related.
That's how they found out.
Yeah, that some people are having allergic reactions.
Joe Rogan's like, oh shit. Oh. Some crazy shit's happening.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, all right. Damn. Fair enough, dude. That's crazy. But yeah, I mean, honestly, I've never tried to eat a cockroach, so it's good to know. Okay. It's good to know just in case I ever
just
am in a situation.
Go like on that. A hunt. No, just like
oh, I've seen. I saw one really recently. But it was no good.
He
was a mean
recently.
Guy, dude. Yeah.
No. I had
he was a mean guy, dude. I didn't like him at all.
Gabby was at, so it's talking about Gabby smoking weed, right? So she's out
oh,
front.
Oh, snap. You saying that on the podcast? Well,
on the cast?
On the cast.
Wow, we.
For all
right. She's going to be so mad at you.
Can you zoom in on my face and give me like a like.
This guy.
So I go to the backyard to smoke, right? She goes to the front yard. And Gabby's so freaking like, I don't give a fuck. She's all legal. Blah, blah, blah. So she'll go out there and smoke. And she goes, oh my gosh, babe, come here. And I go outside, and there's a fucking big ass roach like that. Oof. And I'm barefoot, nice. So I was like, step on this poor dude. Like,
with
I
your
can't
feet, with your bare feet.
Well, no.
I thought you were gonna eat it. That's what I thought.
Right, no, it's not going. There. No, it ends pretty sad. So anyway, so like pick up rocks, and I start hitting it, and I'm just like barely like hitting them. I was like, oh dude, I'm torturing this poor thing, right? So I was like, hey, bring me my chancla, right? And so she comes out and she just gives me some cockroach spray. And I was like, oh, okay. And he's like trying to run off. And so I go up and I'm like, all right, sorry, buddy. I start spraying him as he's like tucked in. And he turns around and he's just like this. As I'm spraying, and I'm just like, man. I feel like such a murderer. Like, cause it wasn't like it faced me. It faced me and like stared into my soul. And it's like,
yeah.
No.
Damn.
Yeah, and then I had to go to work.
Dude.
I had to go to work with that feeling.
Yeah.
It was not a good start to the day.
Nah, that's great. You see, the one that I saw, I trapped him. I had him trapped under like
you had a chance
glass.
To eat him.
I had every chance to eat him, dude, for sure. I could have just like popped him right in. But I was feeling pretty full from my dinner that night, so I wasn't feeling like I should eat this cockroach. Yeah, plus, I guess I'm allergic. We've discovered, so it's a good thing I didn't. But
huge swell up.
But no, I flushed him down the toilet. I was definitely not trying to be like, all right, I've caught this cockroach. Now let's go let him go in the woods, you know?
Yeah.
I was like, no, wait, this thing is a vermin. He's got to go, dude.
Vermin.
Yeah, he's got friends. Yeah, like, they got to go too, you know?
Exactly.
So, yeah, I was like.
You let one in.
No remorse, dude. That thing's got to go.
Yeah.
Some animals are cool, but I don't know about the cockroach.
Like snakes? You know?
I like snakes. See, a snake is cool. And
I do not like snakes
would eat
all.
Other things that I consider to be vermin. So that's why he's my boy. Like a spider. A spider is like, he's my boy.
Do snakes eat spiders?
Yeah, for sure.
If they're big enough, yeah.
But like even a spider like will eat other bugs. So if I see a spider chilling like on my property, if it's inside, it's got to go.
You got to go.
If it's outside, I'm like, all right, yeah, dude, get those bugs, dude. I hate those guys, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like, he's cool. He's my boy.
A spider's good to keep every now and then.
Cockroach? I don't know about that. You know? I think that guy's got to go. They get up in your food, dude. Like, they're no good.
Do you think there are other animals besides birds that are working for the CIA?
Oh, I think probably, dude. Yeah.
Really? Like, what other kinds of animals do you think?
Probably some kind of
definitely
fish.
A ferret, dude.
Like a squirrel?
A ferret? It just seems like, yeah, a CIA bred, like, animal.
Very interesting.
A ferret.
You think they're like going on little missions and stuff? You know?
Picture them in little suits, dude.
Dang.
Yeah.
That's
oh
high
my
tech.
Goodness.
That,
yeah,
the proportions on that suit would be ridiculous.
They fit like anywhere.
Her body is so long.
Yeah. That and an octopus.
An octopus in a suit?
No, see, an octopus is intergalactic CIA, dude.
Yeah, definitely octopus like has some alien type vibes.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
I got guy right here. He's right here.
Yeah.
My octopus.
Fucking
real alien type vibes.
They super do camouflage, like 8 different hearts.
Yeah, and just the way they move.
They have 8 different hearts?
They have 3 hearts, I think.
Oh yeah. What? No, brains. I was thinking brains. So each one is independently controlled, each tentacle.
But they have 8 different brains.
Something like that. Like each either they a have, fucking brain.
Yeah, they have like I don't know, whatever the hell it is.
If only
they
we
have,
had like, a
inside
phone
your
to
brain,
check
but in their tentacles so that they can like move them independently, you know? And they like process things like independently. So when they're like moving around, each one is like feeling out its way, like they're like picking up on all that.
Dude, they're so smart. It's a fucking other level.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy stuff.
Like if you came across an octopus on like fucking Titan or something, one of the moons, you'd be like, holy shit, look at this advanced being.
But that explains it, dude.
But we've just grown up with it, so it's like, yeah, it's an octopus.
Yeah, now that I think about it, it's totally an alien, huh?
It's nuts, dude. And you've seen the mimic octopus?
The which one?
The mimic octopus. It's it's like an octopus that like makes itself look like other sea creatures, but it can do like a whole bunch of different ones.
Is it a smaller one, almost like a nautilus?
It's pretty small, yeah. It's like black and white, like striped,
yeah,
like zebra striped.
That's right, yeah.
And yeah, dude, it makes itself look like an eel or like a piece of kelp or like different types of fish, you know, like specifically like this is trying to mimic like that fish, you know, like it's this crazy thing. The thing's a genius.
Intergalactic CIA, bro.
And it's like it's like several different things too. Like he must just like see him and be like, oh yeah, I could look like that, you know. It's the craziest thing.
It's basically the mimic Frank Caliendo of
dude, for
the
real.
Ocean.
No doubt. It's like, okay, who am I now? All the other octopus are laughing at him, you know.
Yeah. Stand-up octopus comedian.
This guy, I can't even take him anymore. He's hilarious, this octopus.
Oh, shit, dude. So when do you anticipate this album?
Oh, that's a good question, man. Mm-hmm.
Do you have any soft dates?
The end of the year. Probably before the end of the year, I would say.
Josiah says next month it better be done, dude.
Next month, yeah. I feel like we're going to get a lot of work done this summer. You know, I feel like that there's going to be a surplus of work in the summer, you know. But we're doing some, we're playing some shows and doing some things. We're going down to Bisbee for like this little weekend type of thing, July 16th and 17th. We're bringing some bands down there.
Nice. That's down near Tucson, right?
It's about an hour and 20 or 30 minutes past Tucson.
Tucson.
It's like close to the border of Mexico. Yeah, you know, Juan, if you've never been.
I've never been, dude. I am so fucking traveled. Is that a fucking word? It is now. I am so untraveled.
He's never been there either.
But I have never been to Bisbee. That's
but he's been to the Grand Canyon.
I haven't been to the Grand Canyon since I was a wee little lad.
Dude, I've lived in Arizona my whole life. I've never been to the Grand Canyon.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Dude. Wow.
Okay. I know. I'm a piece of shit.
It's worth the trip. You should come to Bisbee first.
Worth the trip.
Oh, yeah.
And then go to the Grand Canyon.
All right. Do they have golf down in Bisbee?
I think there's a course down there. Yeah.
Perfect.
There is.
Yeah. I've gotten into that sport.
How's your game coming along?
Oh, it's shitty.
We haven't played in a minute.
Oh, that's right. I know. We got to line something up. Lee, you're coming.
Yeah. I'll do it. I don't have clubs or anything, but I will do it. I'll definitely do it.
Coming along.
No doubt.
Did you still have all those clubs that you bought? You bought like 4 different sets, didn't you?
I gave
like
a bunch away.
Juan's backup
I have
set.
A spare. I have a spare set, actually.
Do you?
Yeah, I kept one just for when somebody wants to go. Yeah.
Nice. Very cool.
Are you right-handed?
Yeah.
Okay, sweet, because I'm left-handed. You can't use mine.
No, I have a spare set. We'll be sitting pretty.
All right. That's what it's all about.
So the 16th and the 17th, so you're doing two...
July 16th and 17th at Bisbee Grand and Bisbee Social Club. Possibly some more venues involved, but that's it for right now.
That's what's set.
Yeah, yeah. And then, you know, we got a thing coming up at Yucca Tap Room on June 17th.
Yeah, plug away, man. June 17th at Yucca.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that's still on Southern and Mill, right?
That's still where it's at. They haven't moved. But they did open a new location
in North.
In Flagstaff called Yucca North. Yeah. Have you been there, Josiah? Is it sweet?
It's awesome there.
Yeah? Yeah? Is it like a cool stage and everything?
That's the thing. The venue is closed.
So oh, it's just
I
a bar?
Think, yeah, it's just the bar. And then the you know, the arcade and the pinball machines and shit.
Gotcha.
That part looks great, though. And then they closed off the rest. But did you ever go to the green room up in Flagstaff? That was the venue.
Okay.
Oh, is that the venue that the Yucca is now?
Yucca just took over the green room.
Gotcha. Okay, that's what my next question was. Was it a fresh build or was it a...
It was, they just took over that building, and so they're going to renovate the venue and hopefully make it pretty sweet. Because the green room was fine, but it was kind of shitty, you know?
Yeah. Whatever, you know?
I'm sure some people are upset about that. But I'm sure some people are going to be like, dope.
I wonder when they're going to reopen that venue, because I would love to play in Flagstaff.
Yeah, we should definitely do something in Flagstaff, yeah.
Hell yeah, dude.
There's a couple different places to play up there. There's a few.
Do a little playing, a little hiking.
Yeah. How far is the canyon from Flag?
Maybe like another 2 hours? Probably less than 2 hours, you know.
Yeah.
It's probably another hour, you know, yeah. Hour and change, I guess, yeah.
It's not that far.
No doubt. It's not too bad.
I need to go and see that hole in the ground.
Wow, when are you going to come and, like, do some hiking with us?
Well, Mondays are my total free day.
Totally free.
We can do something super early in the morning any other day. So if we wanted to get up and do, like, look at his face already.
I'm with you on the getting up early.
Yeah, sometimes I do the get up early. Okay, that was like a mixed reaction.
We can hit a 5:30, 6 a.m. hike. Yeah, see?
I'd have to plan that.
Yeah,
that's good, though. That's a good time to do it because you get the sunrise and stuff, you know? But yeah, dude, I definitely am. I'm down for that anytime. Yeah. What time do you usually work? 10?
Yeah, I go in at 10, so usually, you know, I can get a lot done. What's up?
You're at Mesa still?
Yeah.
Nice. Very
cool. Yeah, so like right now, I usually got that workout group that I'm a part of, and we do...
Oh, nice.
I do Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday... and Saturday at 6 a.m. and then 5:30 yoga on Fridays.
Jeez.
And so after that, I'm pretty much like I just rush home, kind of chill for a little bit, and then go to work. Yeah. So
can you teach us some yoga stuff?
Yeah, dude. You want to do some right now?
Where do you go for the to do that working out stuff? Like, where do you guys go?
So the group is called F3. I'm gonna plug you. I'm gonna get you guys into my cult. The Very group cool. is called Very F3, cool. and it stands for fitness. Fellowship, which is the friendship shit, what we're doing here. Nice. And then faith is basically just, you know, a belief in something greater than yourself. Like,
no doubt.
Everybody knows I'm an atheist. But it always ends in some sort of prayer, you know,
yeah, at the end.
Everybody gets a nickname. It's one of, you know, those. It's just bonding more. Actually, which is pretty cool.
What's your nickname? It's Grimbo?
No, it's Rage.
Rage.
Which everybody's like, why'd you get such a cool nickname? Because everybody... Everybody's like Streaker, Prairie Dog,
Bingo,
Forest,
Dumbass. Prairie Dog because he had to poop.
Yeah. So you get a nickname just like you would anywhere else.
Spitball.
You know? Yeah.
That's a good one.
This is funny. So one of the guys was talking about how there's a dude in town because F3 is all around the country. And so, yeah, actually, today I met a guy from Atlanta. And he actually led the workout today. And he was just like, I'm in town. I'm going up to Sholo. And I'm leaving back to Atlanta on Friday. Nice. And this dude came in and we fucking, you know, it's like when you're part of a group. Like if you meet somebody that went to Bravado Van, you would kind of have that link already, right?
Yeah, for sure.
So even if you don't know him. No doubt. It's kind of like that same thing. You can go to another city and just jump right in.
Yeah. What kind of workouts? Is it like high intensity? Impact training type stuff.
That's the beauty of it is that it's peer led. For one, it's peer led. It's men only. It's outdoors, rain, shine, snow, no matter what. And it's always free. I feel like I'm leaving one out. But it's peer led, which means there's a huge variety.
Always free. That's really tight. I like that.
Yeah. So it's just show up because everybody knows the hardest thing about working out, physical activity is literally just showing up to the gym, showing up to the fuck part. It's dragging yourself out of bed. That's the fucking. Once you're in it, it's just like, all right, let's go one foot in front of the other.
Yeah.
But yeah, it changes. Everybody's a little bit different. Sometimes we just play ultimate frisbee.
Nice.
Like it's kind of like whatever they're gonna lead at that point. Today was a pretty brutal one.
Yeah.
Today was a pyramid scheme. Type of working. Yeah, it was a pyramid scheme type. That's what I called it because nobody
liked it. You got to get 10 of your friends to join F3. They'll get 10 of their friends.
So it started at the top. It was 60 push-ups.
Okay.
And then it drops down 50 of this and this and then 40 of these. And then in between, we had to run up these stadium steps. So there's a pretty dope dog park out on Gilbert, or no, Greenfield and Ray. And it has auditorium steps that are like range from this high to this high. So it's brutal going up and down those. So we did those in between. And then at any point in time, one of the guys one time during the workout could yell, Leroy Jenkins. That classic fucking thing. No doubt. And that meant that you had to do 10 burpees on the spot. Yeah, everybody did.
Yeah, no doubt.
So today was a pretty rigorous one, but it always varies, dude.
Yeah.
And that's the beauty of it. You don't know what you're going to get entirely. You kind of have an idea because once, you know, like if you lead it, you might find out that, oh, Lee really likes to do lunges or he really likes abs or something that. Like you kind of get the gist of it, but it always varies. Anyways, there's multiple locations throughout the valley. The main ones that I hit are going to be a Tempe Beach Park North Shore near like the Marquee. Uh-huh. And then I do the dog park down there by Top Golf in Gilbert. And then there's the Gilbert Regional Park that's on Saturdays and Fridays for yoga down on Ahwatukee. So it's usually a park, usually outdoors, somewhere where there's, you know, room for activities.
Yeah.
For a hill. We love hills.
No doubt.
Because they kill. But again, the hardest thing is literally just showing up. And it's a good group of dudes, man. Like, I don't know. It's a good group of dudes.
Yeah, it's all like posted online, like the location of every week and stuff.
Yeah, you just go to f3nation.com or f3phoenix, and they will tell you all the workout locations, the days and the times that they work out.
Nice.
Yeah, and it's, you know.
Then like you just like, if you're, like you're new, you just show up and you're like, hey dudes, I'm here to like burn some cows.
Yeah, exactly. You just roll up. Yeah, everybody's welcome. Like,
they're gonna haze you though. On your first day, they're going to be like, all right, 400 push-ups, you know?
No, they won't. No. That's a fine line. You don't want to freaking, you know, scare somebody away where they don't come back. Sure. Yeah, yeah. No, it's not. And nobody. One thing you realize, it's one of the things that the guy said today, is like, you realize that, like, nobody's really paying attention to you because they're struggling with their own shit.
Yeah,
no doubt. Nobody's like, oh, that guy isn't, like, you know, doing this or doing that or whatnot. Yeah. It's like, dude, you showed up, dude, hats off. Like, let's go.
Yeah.
That's all it is.
That's what it's all about. I have not, like, since moving back out here, like, not gotten into it. I had a good workout routine going back at home in New Jersey, you know? Mm-hmm. And I brought my weights with me. I have, like, 2 kettlebells and 1 dumbbell, you know?
Yeah.
And, like, that's 3 kettlebells. That's all I have, you know? But I haven't really set up, like, the space to, like,
mm-hmm.
get back into it yet, you know?
So. It's about the space and the routine. It's not necessarily the tools that you have at that point. It's really just going through the motions.
No doubt.
It's like writing a song, man. If you're going to wait.
I thought about joining the gym that's like right next to the Guitar Center, you know?
Yeah. But, I mean, if it's going to get you
going.
But I'll
see where you guys are at one of these days. Dude, cause like,
there's a one called The Range up in northern Scottsdale. There's two locations in Scottsdale, and then there's the one Tempe.
Yeah,
I don't know where you're staying right now.
Right now, I'm in like downtown Phoenix.
Oh yeah, there should be a few around there too.
Nice.
Yeah, just let me know if you want to fucking. I'll let you know the locations.
No doubt, dude.
But it's just setting up the routine, man. It's like if you waited to have like all the perfect recording equipment, you would never get started. Like it's literally just setting up the routine. It's just getting going. It's just putting it into motion.
No doubt,
making it a habit.
Yeah,
that's like the easy part for me. Like I'm like, I love like I can settle into a routine really easily, you know. And then it's more so like being out of it is like what bothers me, you know. So like since I've been out here, that's like 2 months that I haven't been working out, and like usually like that is really built into my routine.
Yeah.
So it like weighs heavy on my conscience where I'm like, oh my god, it's like another day that I've not worked out.
I still did.
Yeah, it's for sure. Like I still think about it, you know. So like getting like. Being in that routine is like what I want, you know?
Yeah.
But it's tricky, dude, because I'm like bouncing around in Airbnbs and stuff right now, you know? So like my routine is getting shaken up every month.
For sure.
You know?
Yeah. For sure.
And so, you know, you just got to roll with it. Like, I'm still doing a lot of hiking and stuff, you know?
Good.
Right. It's not like you're just like sitting on the couch, like eating donuts, playing video games.
No, I mean, I definitely like
that. That fucking sounds amazing, though.
Sometimes I play video games.
But dude, you're like super active, you know?
No doubt. I definitely try to get moving.
Yeah, just something.
Yeah.
I mean, if you just get up and do 10 squats, That's 10 squats you wouldn't have done otherwise.
Yeah, no doubt.
Right. Do it. That's it. They don't take much, man.
Just some light calisthenics go a long way.
Dude, the old calisthenics.
You got to stay limber.
You can get jacked just like just calisthenics, you know? Well, there's plenty of people who do it.
Yeah. I did a lot of calisthenics when I lost my weight.
Yeah, no doubt.
Well, you do a motion long enough, it's going to get tiring.
Yeah, for sure.
Literally, we have one of the ones that's called a hallelujah, and this is all you do.
Yeah.
Bro, you do that for 2 minutes, your fucking shoulders are wrecked for like, no doubt. Don't try to do push-ups right after that. It's literally just that, just hallelujahs.
Do you have to like sing it while you do
it? No. That's just what it's called. Yeah. No. And then there's always ways you can make shit harder. Like, you can just stand and do that, or you can hold a squat and do that.
Oh, dang, true. No.
There's always ways to modify, either making it harder or easier.
No doubt.
Just like you can get a cord buddy.
True.
You remember Cord Buddy?
Cord Buddy for
guitar?
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you can modify the guitar.
I've seen that thing. I've never seen one like sold.
In use?
You know? Sold. Yeah, but I've seen it.
I've sold a few, unfortunately.
The Cord Buddy?
Yeah.
But the thing with like the different color buttons and stuff, yeah, like, makes your guitar like a Guitar Hero?
You hold the button and it plays the chord for you. Exactly. Yeah, I mean, it does get you. That's here's high the tech. Thing. Here's the fucking thing, dude. It's like Guitar Hero, right? If it's going to get you interested in the guitar and then eventually you actually pick up a real guitar, hey, it helped in that
you're
sense.
Right, you're right. Yeah.
If playing.
It provides inspirado.
Yeah. If you push a button and it gives you the chord and you're playing it and it brings you joy to do that, and eventually you can remove those pieces and you can physically do the chord yourself, it brings you closer to playing the guitar. Okay. All right.
No doubt.
But
I will say, though, that as like in the times that I was like a music teacher, you know, like when I was teaching people that like were really beginners, you know, I just like came to realize that like starting off people, especially kids with like chords and stuff, it's just impossible, you know, like trying to teach a kid and be like, all right, play this G chord. It looks like this. You got to do this crazy stuff with your hand, you know, like they're never going to.
That was almost like you flicked off that kid.
Oh, yeah.
They're never going to like stick with that, you know. So I always teach them the way to do chords that's like where you only have to play like one note. There's my G chord. There's my C. You know.
Almost like ukulele
it's
chords.
Like the easy, yeah, exactly. You know, it's like the easy versions and stuff, you know. And then you can even do like these like little easy versions of other things.
Yeah, keeping it to two or three chords.
So it winds up being the same thing. Strings. Like you're still just pushing one button in order to like create the same effect, you know?
Yeah, man.
And then you don't need that extra tool, you know? That's what
I
it's all about.
I wish you were my guitar teacher when I was a kid.
Did you have somebody whipping you, dude?
There's this old man. His name was Frank Anastas.
Frank Anastas.
And he had the longest fingernails I'd ever seen on a male.
Which, like, his plucking hand,
his
right?
His plucking hand. Oh, yeah. I didn't know at the time, you know.
Did he do coke?
Maybe. Yeah, probably. Yeah. I think, yeah, he totally did coke. Yeah. Yeah. He smoked it snorted it.
Okay.
Classic cocaine Eric Clapton. Little jam. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know.
Was he like a classical, like classically trained type dude? Is that why he had the long nails, or was he just like fucking around?
I think he was fucking around.
Fair enough.
He was like the super like. Sorry, Frank. If you ever hear this, I'm sorry, but I love you, dude. But Frank was, you know, didn't have like the like most upbeat personality type of thing, so. It was kind of just like the few months I did take lessons with him. It was kind of just like, oh, man. Great. Here comes Tuesday night.
Well, as a teacher, does that kind of get beaten out of you, though, to a certain point?
That's got it, right?
Right?
Because it's definitely a challenge, yeah, to like try to maintain the that like enthusiasm for teaching people the same stuff, you know? Because it's like any student... Like, if you've done it long enough, any student, no matter what point they're at, is going to be at a point in their learning that, like, you've already been through, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
like, a lot of it is, like, you know, hitting the same stuff over and over again. You get a new student, and you're going back to, okay, now let me teach them this G chord and this C chord, and let me teach them EADGBE, you know, every good boy or whatever, you know, if you're doing the staff, you know, every good boy does fine or all that stuff, you know, it's like, it's definitely more interesting as a teacher to be able to like dive to a depth where like you're putting your own knowledge like to the test, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. So that's more like engaging, yeah. But you know, it's all about like, the best guitar player is probably not going to be the best teacher, you know? Mm-hmm. And the best teacher is going to be somebody that does have that patience.
It's the same thing with athletes.
Yeah. You know? Yeah, for sure. Exactly. Yeah. Like, yeah, definitely like the best like coaches are not necessarily like the best football player right now.
Yeah.
on the field, you know? Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's just like how it is. It's like, I don't know. I mean, music is like a big old... There's so much to it. It's big. It's just like a big, like endless, like stew, you know. And so, like, you gotta find ways to like stay enthusiastic about it, like with your students, like no matter what they're doing, no matter like where they're at in like their journey of like learning, you gotta definitely let them know, like, there's a lot of interesting stuff going on here, dude. You know, and so I think it can be easy to kind of like fall out of that and like, you know, think like, all right, like I gotta teach these kids like a C chord. Mm-hmm. Again, you know, but for me as a teacher, I would just kind of like find the things that people did respond to when I would teach them all like the same thing, you know.
Yeah.
And then I would use that stuff like over and over again, you know. So for the strings of a guitar, EADGBE, you know, eat a darn good breakfast every day. That's something I would tell the students. That's how I'd get them to remember it, you know.
Yeah.
And I'd be like, you got to remember that for two reasons. One, because those are the strings on your guitar. EADGBE, eat a darn good breakfast every day. Two, you got to eat a darn good breakfast every day. If you don't do that, it's the most important meal of the day. So stuff like that, dude, makes the kids laugh, you know? They're going to remember that now.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
that's like a go-to thing. I would say that every time because I knew already from having done it, this is going to be something that's going to be engaging for the kids, you know?
It's like you're a stand-up comic and you come in with your opening line. You know, it's going to land.
I had a few go-to, like, and you could see, like, you know, like from having gone through school and stuff that you had some teachers that had the same kind of thing going on, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
They definitely had jokes that they did, like, every year with every new class, you know?
Right.
But, you know, if you know that it's going to be something that's helpful and engaging for the kid, then, like, that's what's important, you know. And it's definitely a good way to engage yourself, you know, if you're cracking a few jokes and stuff instead of being like, okay, like let me teach somebody again that a C chord is C-E-G, you know. Right. It's like, I don't know, whatever attitude you bring to the table is like, that's the attitude that you're going to be like sharing with your student, you know.
Yeah.
And so if you got a bad attitude, then like they're going to view it as homework, you know.
Right. What about you, Juan? Are you still cracking jokes on stage?
Oh no.
Cracking jokes on stage.
I fell out. Well, for one,
I never got to come see Do Your Thing.
No, it wasn't any good, dude.
You were doing something.
I got
like,
one of the guys. One of the guys told me, he's like, "You're all set up, and no punchline." I was like, "Oh shit!"
What, really? Yeah. Someone told you that?
Yeah, one of the main guys. And
you're like, "Hey, here's a punchline for you." Well,
bam. No, he's disabled.
Oh man,
what? That's not funny.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Touché.
No. I would like to maybe pick it up again and, you know, just have it. Cause just, I don't know. It's kind of like the same way, like this is set up where it's more of a conversation. And that's how my style was just more like, it wasn't like, you know, punchline wasn't set up and punchline. Like, yeah, I saw a bunch of those guys and, you know, some of them were pretty cool. They would do like the same stuff like every week. Obviously you're trying to nail it. You know, because that's the thing, is like as a musician, you can practice the same riff in your bedroom like all fucking day then take it to the show. Whereas like in stand up, the show is you practicing. You can't just like practice in front of the mirror.
Yeah, that's
true.
You can,
but it only gets you so far because you're gauging the audience.
Yeah, no doubt.
To an extent, your instrument is almost the audience.
Yeah.
In that sense.
I feel you.
I mean... Your instrument is more or less your voice and, you know, how you deliver it. But I don't know, what can it be quite like fucking the feedback that you get from the audience?
It's different because it's going to definitely impact the performance, you know? So if you're standing like at home doing it in the mirror, then you can try to anticipate what people are going to say, you know? But if somebody's just out there, you know, like
you suck.
Yeah.
What do you do now? You know?
How many times I never did the whole mirror thing, but just to myself, like driving to work, I would like come up with the line, be like, oh yeah, cool. And then I fucking performed it like that night or the next night or something. And it just did not. And I was like, why did I picture that going so differently? Yeah, you just that's don't so know funny. Until you fucking.
Yeah, you have one that true. Was like a killer every time.
Not really. Well, there was one I had like a really bad set, and it was complaining about being in retail and how when people call and they're like, hey, I have a question. I was like, no shit, dude. Like, that's the whole reason this phone line exists. You don't just call and give me a statement. Like, you're calling because you want information, right? Or you have a question. So, like, that irritates me. So, like, that was part of the line. And then it was talking about, like, people that don't know directions. And it was not landing anywhere. Everybody was fucking shit. So, I had dropped a line the week before. At this other place, so I just kind of brought it back, and I was like, well, and so I knew it was gonna land, and it was like when my beard gets long, I was like, you know, most people think like I'm Middle Eastern, and Middle East, like being Middle Eastern is not cool unless you got the Middle Eastern money, but what's the worst thing about being people thinking that you're Middle Eastern? Oh, people think you like to fuck goats. When in actuality, sheep are the most generous lovers. Something like that, yeah. And so, like, that one would land when I deliver it more properly. But it was basically that's like, oh, you think you fuck goats? When in actuality, sheep are the most generous lovers. And then I got like, some good laughs. And the one guy was like, yeah, your last line was good. And I was all, thanks, dude. But it was the most brutal, like, 4 minutes. Like, yeah.
Really?
It's yeah, man. You're up there. You're trying to make people laugh.
Brutal, dude. Yeah.
Yeah, like, you're up there trying to make people laugh.
It's different from, like, I feel like you get a more supportive audience, like, as a musician, even if you're, like, a sort of, like, very novice musician. Right. People are like, oh, yeah, well, he's trying, you know?
Mm-hmm,
but,
mm-hmm.
like, I don't think that it's the same for, like, stand-up comedians. Yeah, I feel right. like people definitely, like, you know, just, like, treat them off the bat with, like, a thing that's like, okay, like, if this guy's not good, we're tearing him apart, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, like, I'm like, going to boo this guy.
You're
for
here,
sure.
you're here to make me laugh. Whereas yeah, a musician's no like, well, you're here to play sounds. The other thing, too, is that generally there is a genre that you're there to see. So you're going to see a blues band and maybe like rock blues, but ultimately it'll be in that same vein. You're not going to see fucking pop synth band there. But when you go no see doubt. An open mic or a comedy right. show, you're going to see different styles
yeah,
in general.
Very true.
Yeah.
Do you ever get anybody who's just like their style is just like to be really loud?
One guy, yeah, his style was to be not so much loud, but
see
so
a lot of
angry.
Comedians, yeah, just kind of screaming.
Angry and
stuff,
misogynistic,
yeah.
dude. But he was so oh, fucking dang. Funny, dude. And that's the thing. That's what makes it funny is that you're not supposed to be saying that stuff.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah.
That's what makes it no funny. Doubt. You know, it's like, oh, dude, you're saying some fucking.
I think it's funny to have like a kind of like personality. Like, I feel like if I did something like that, I would probably like develop like a character and.
Yeah.
And really lean into it, you know?
That's the story behind Dice Clay.
Yeah,
Dice,
absolutely.
The Dice Man was his character.
I think a few of them, yeah, like
the redneck cat. What's his name?
Larry the Cable Guy.
Yeah, that was one of his characters, and that's no just doubt. What took off. And now that's all you know him for.
Yeah, for sure.
You know,
I feel like they get lost in it too. Like definitely Andrew Dice Clay. Like he became that guy.
Yeah,
you
know? Yeah.
Sam Kinison.
Absolutely.
I mean, you get he was known for being fucking the life of the party in the Cokehead, right? So. Anytime you went out, it's like, let's do coke with Sam, dude. And it's like,
dang.
He's like, yeah, I'm fucking burnt out.
Yeah, you know? No, that dude.
It's almost like you get pigeonholed, you know?
Yeah.
To a sense. Yeah, play another track. Let me hit the head real quick. Follow Josiah.
You're going to go all right. follow Josiah into the bathroom?
Is he going to the bathroom?
Are you
going to
go?
I don't know where he's going.
You guys going to go pee together?
we're going to combine streams, dude.
And make sure you just get it in the toilet. Come on. So we're just gonna play to.
You're playing to the audience. What are you talking about?
Well, there's nobody like in the room anymore. Then if you're gonna go pee, it's gonna be like.
All right. Well, all right then. Why don't you play like a funny riff, and then you guys can crack jokes about me.
Okay.
that's my funny riff. You know, it's just Cars for Kids. Brought to you by
KIRS.
Are we allowed to say that? I don't know what the rules are in the podcast game, dude. We're gonna have to bring out the, you know,
Yeah, the last time I was on Juan's podcast, book.
He was like, surprised. Don't mention Mickey Mouse, because I'll get banned from Facebook.
Straight up
That's classic.
Juan's probably got a bunch of copyright infringements going on right now.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah, like, you can't use the name this Juan time, you know, because there's other guys named Juan in the world, and they're...
They have time also.
They're pissed.
You know?
They're pissed, dude. Let's see. We could do some little music in the interim. This is the music that you would hear if you were going to take a piss right now.
And just imagine releasing that urine to this song right here. Josiah, you're not peeing with Juan right now?
Just like one at a time?
Yeah, I invited him in.
Okay. You know, it saves time and water, actually, if you just pee with your friends at the same time.
Yeah.
All together.
That's what we do here in the Metropolis, man.
Just looking out for the environment.
Mm-hmm. Especially the more the better, when we can get all four of our streams in one toilet at the same time.
Saving so much water, dude. Yeah. Doing so much good for the environment. The ozone? That's what it's all about.
No. You're saving more water than if you had all peed. Like, say Alex would pee.
Say I'm peeing.
And then Leanne goes in, pees, doesn't flush. Tyler goes in, pees, doesn't flush. And then the last guy goes and pees, and then flushes. Is that the same?
So you mean we all pee, the four of us individually? Uh-huh. Into the same toilet, but do not flush until the last person pees. No, I don't like it.
It's not the same.
I mean, I guess you could pee one at a time.
You totally.
That's what you wanted to do.
You save so much more time just by like peeing all together.
You really save a lot of time. Yeah.
Time, but is time more important than the environment?
Yeah, time is money. Plus, then you can't see your friends' dicks.
Classic.
Oh, sorry, I was showing off your cup there.
Nice. Excellent. That's this Juan time cup.
So is your logo a guitar pick with your hands?
It's really not. It just turned out that way.
It does look like a guitar pick, yeah.
It definitely
did. Buy that from Guitar Center? At a discount?
No. Made that. I bought that off my website. ThisWantime.com.
Nice.
Where can you find ThisWantime.com?
On the good old interwebs.
Oh.
Any on the World Wide Web. Browser, Internet Explorer. That's my favorite of the browser.
Can you do it on Mozilla Firefox?
I think that's another one, yeah.
That one's still up and running, right? Yeah, you always got to update that one.
That's classic stuff.
Well, what do you got for us, gents?
We could do another one here. This is a song
for the ladies.
Well, yeah, I guess it's for boys and ladies. This one, it's for both genders. This one.
No, that's not it. Which was the one that you were just saying? That was this is a song for the ladies. Oh, but fellas, listen closely.
Tenacious D.
Oh, Tenacious D. Yeah, okay.
Oh,
yeah.
It is. That's right.
Yeah, I just like, I caught
Don't
it. I caught it when you said.
Have to do that thing hard.
I thought we agreed this was not for kids. This is.
Oh, yeah,
this
yeah, yeah. Okay. No, you can definitely say the most vulgar shit on here.
That's probably another copyright infringement right there. That's true. Saying Tenacious D song.
Jack Black is true. Cool. But Kyle Gass is who you got to worry about.
Juan, if you ever get like famous, you're going to have so many like. Letters of infringement.
Yeah, I know. I accidentally said Mickey Mouse before when you were in the bathroom.
Sorry. I did. Wait, you can't even say Mickey Mouse?
Not that bad. Dude, you're going to have to bleep that.
Yeah.
You're going to have to fix that in post.
Yeah.
Cut that part out.
I had to bookmark it.
That's a no-go. All right, what should we do? What should we play? You got...
I can't tell if my guitar is on or off.
Well, turn that bitch up.
Well, dude,
that's off.
That's off and this is on?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Okay. If you say so, Juan.
It's just, we should have had you go into a DI first.
Yeah, what? We have one of those, don't we?
No? No, you'll be fine. I'll just boost it.
All right, okay, what do we got?
All right,
I'll turn that sumbitch to 11.
Ooh.
Oh, wow.
That sweet, sweet boost.
That's a lot of numbers.
That's two ones.
Okay, so this is a song here about, you know, just like trying to become a better dude, you know?
Ain't we all?
Yeah. Waking up on a wet bed sheet, 'cause last night I drank enough for three. But I let it get the best of me, 'cause these sheets haven't been clean for weeks. Let's get real high and go out to eat. There's a Chinese buffet right down the street. They ran out of beef and broccoli. I just had to eat enough for three. Feeling stuck and I'm lonely, with no good influence. Wishing I could just leave all this empty. The time when I load the bomb and forget all the things that I've done wrong. Feeling stuck and I'm lonely, with no good influence. Wishing I could just leave all of this emptiness. Do I have time to change still? Is it too late to try? If I can't see a future when I close my eyes. I'm tired of being big old bear. Gonna lose some weight and grow my hair. Something that I should declare. My heart's in need of some repair. Feeling stuck and I'm lonely, with no good influence. Wishing I could just leave all of this emptiness. Do I have time to change still? Is it too late to try? If I can't see a future when I close my eyes, I want something to strive for. I want to give a damn. Know my mind can be proud of the man that I am.
Yeah. So good, man.
It's called Enough for Three. Thank you, Juan.
Yeah. It's a good track.
It's a, it's, you know, it's one that a lot of people can relate to if they have slipped up in any way in their life, you know, whether it's with some kind of addiction or, you know, whatever.
Anything.
Yeah, you know, it's just about pick yourself back up on that horse and get going. That's all. Yeehaw.
It's all about acknowledging it, man. I mean, if you don't acknowledge it, then you can't yeehaw. You know, you have to take the moment to, you know, see it with clear eyes and admit.
You got to decide to get better.
You got to decide. Ain't that the crazy thing?
Because it won't happen on its own, you know?
Yeah, dude, ain't that crazy, dude? Look, no matter how much you try, like, unless that person decides, like, it's time, like, there's, you can't do anything.
But it's not just a single decision. You got to make that decision every day.
That's very true. Excellent point.
Yeah.
Yeah, no doubt.
And then, you know, there'll be times when you forget to make that decision. You just got to get back to making that decision.
Very true.
Yeah, it's very easy to just be like, oh, fuck, I slipped up. Whoa, fuck it.
Yeah, no doubt.
Yeah. It's way more courageous to, you know, be like, yeah, I slipped up, but let's start again.
Right.
Woo. It's heavy.
Yeah, I guess, yeah.
Come on, man.
When I asked Lee to join this band, I was like, and he was like, yeah, sure, dude. And I was like, dude, we're going to be playing a lot of really gay stuff here. Like, are you sure you want to come and play here? He's like, dude, I got lots of gay songs.
Yes.
It's like, perfect. We should be gay together.
Yeah. Lay it on thick.
Yeah, dude.
Love it.
How long is this podcast, man?
I don't know. I want to get Josiah on, so one of you motherfuckers need to get off the mic.
Oh, yeah, sure, dude. Yeah.
Oh, snap. You want to switch? You want to switch with me?
Yeah. Should we? Okay.
You can stay.
All right. Should I stay? Yeah, that'd be fine. Yeah, sure.
I'll do a little switch. I'll dance.
Juan, how long have you been going on these podcasts? Like an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours?
What do you mean? My longest one?
No, like what's your average running time here?
The average one I'd probably say is like an hour 40, hour 50, maybe.
Oh, wow. That's pretty long, dude. Just get them out. Jeez Louise. We're probably not even at like 20 minutes yet, are we?
Come on, dude.
It's been about 25 minutes.
It's 9:25, dude. We started at about 7:40.
Whoa.
Yeah, if you want to hop in, take my spot.
Yeah, Josiah, come in here, play some guitar if you want. Or, you know.
Josiah, ladies and gentlemen. Like,
you guys, it's Josiah Rodriguez.
Dude, I will play some guitar. I'll just hold it.
Throw on the headphones, brother.
Yeah.
It's tracking, dude.
He knows. He runs a studio. He knows. He knows the drill.
So Josiah plays in a band called Ultraviolet Communication, which you guys should check out.
I do.
Hell yeah. Where can we find your band and their music?
Spotify, iTunes, Apple Music, YouTube, SoundCloud, whole nine yards, everywhere.
At Ultraviolet?
At most of the time it's just Ultraviolet Communication. Yeah.
Okay.
And then you can find us on Instagram. That's going to be under UVC Band.
UVC Band.
That's right.
Okay, gotcha.
Heck yeah. Awesome. How long have you guys been as that collective?
Probably a little over 2.5 years now, almost 3.
Yeah. Enough to start hating each other.
Yeah. Yeah.
They all live together.
And we all live together.
Oh,
here.
Shit.
So Lee, you met him earlier. Not Leander, but the other guy. He's in the band as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And then we have the other guy. We're just a three piece.
A three piece? Yeah. Nice.
They're like a power trio. When we played up in Havasu like a month ago, we went up there together and. There was this like drunk guy the first night who was like, man, you guys are like Rush. he kept on saying that you're like Rush.
So like each of you playing like a couple different instruments?
I play guitar and then Lee plays drums and then the other guy plays bass. His name's Matt. He plays bass and sings.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, bass and sings. Yeah. Okay. So that's the Rush thing, right?
A little bit, yeah.
Why is it so much harder to play bass and sing?
You know, because like you can kind of mindlessly strum and sing, you know, but with bass you have to like be moving, and like I guess you could kind of just like stick to the root note, but you know, if you're gonna be a bass player, you're gonna like really get into it and yeah, like, do your thing. So yeah, you know, there's been tons of, I'm sure after a while, like if I ask Matt about it, he's like, yeah, it's easy, it's just like without even thinking about it, he can do both.
Yeah, he honed it though.
Yeah,
it's exactly. Hard,
right. Yeah,
it's hard. Because I was
didn't
playing
originally
bass.
Play the bass. He didn't originally play the bass.
No, no, he played guitar, yeah, for a long time. And then he put up an ad. We all met on Craigslist, so he put up an ad, or he responded to an ad, like, to play bass.
Yeah.
Even though he played guitar, mm-hmm. And then he started playing with us and was like, okay, I got to learn bass for reals now. So then he learned bass, and yeah, now he's a bass player, but still just a guitar player at heart, for sure.
Yeah. So,
He actually played the harmonica on that.
That's
song
right. He did. Yeah. He
that
also
we played earlier, "Thirsty Land."
Oh, really?
Yeah. On the recording, Matt's got some harmonica going on.
That's right. Yeah.
Dude.
Yeah. Yeah. He rips on harmonica too. So, the guy's a talented man. He's got a great voice. Plays guitar. Plays bass.
All three of these guys
plays
are
harmonica.
Extremely talented.
I am the least talented in the band.
I'm catching
that.
That's
saying
vibe.
Something. He's super talented.
Oh, that's funny.
Hell yeah.
All right, enough about my band. We're here about Metropolis Man.
No way, dude. Let's plug some UVC.
Oh, yeah, no.
What do you guys got coming up?
We have a show at Rebel Lounge this Saturday, the 29th.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Who are you guys playing with?
We're playing with Twin Ponies. Okay.
Those are good guys.
And Ring Finger No Pinky. It's another band. Never heard of them either.
How much are tickets?
$12 pre-sale.
Okay.
Don't quote me on that.
You said this Saturday.
This Saturday.
Yeah, Lee, let's go to that, dude.
What's that? Dude, yeah. I'll send you the link. Yeah, please come. It'd be so cool to see you guys there. Yeah. They're doing like limited capacity things.
Okay, yeah.
Gotcha. And we played there a couple weeks ago now,
oh,
I think.
Nice.
Yeah, it was kind of funny. I just sent an email over to like the guys who run the shows because we had a couple gigs with them last year at the Rebel Lounge. And I was like, hey, you know, I know you guys are kind of booking shows for the fall, just letting you know we're still around and like booking gigs. So you guys should get in on that. Just send them an email and say, hey, we're a band, you know, because they're just looking to fill out bills. Because
right.
Immediately they sent us an email and they were like, hey, thanks for reaching out. We actually need to fill a bill like next week. Can you play? And we were fuck yeah, we can play. You
should get up in there.
Yeah. So they're doing like a bunch of like local shows, you know, like three bands a show or something on a Wednesday night or something, just to fill them out. And then and then we got this offer from Twin Ponies to play on Saturday, so we're excited about that.
Nice. Have you played with them before?
Never. No, we've met their bass player, I think his name is Phil, once before, and we kind of kept in contact, but he hit us up through the Twin Ponies page, and I guess that we were recommended from the venue, from Rebel, like, hey, you guys would be a good fit for this bill. So they reached out to us and we took the gig. So Saturday we are playing.
There you go.
Hell yeah, man.
That's good. You guys are recording a second album right now.
We are working on a second album. We have one album out now, and we are in the studio this week recording another album. Very excited about that. Yeah. Yeah. It's cool.
Do you have a name for the album yet?
No, we haven't named it yet. No.
What's the name of the first one?
No name for the studio, no name for the album. Just no name, man.
No names everywhere.
Yeah.
The first one is titled Capacity for Illusion.
Right.
Yeah.
But that track is on the second album.
That's right. Then the song is not on the first album, but the song Capacity for Illusion is going to be on the second album.
Whoa, how did that come about?
You
pulled it last minute?
Well, so we wrote the album, the first album, all the way through, and then we finished it and we needed a name, and I had just written the song Capacity for Illusion, but the record was recorded and it was like, this is a really cool name for an album, so we should use it and then just use the song again later. And so we're like, fuck it, yeah, let's do it. And that's what we did, so that's where it is now.
I think that's how you could double dip, man. You could double dip, because if you had that song on the same album, then it's and somebody searches for it, they only get that. But now you kind of get both searches.
Oh, yeah. Both will come up.
It was all a marketing scheme to begin with.
Genius.
You know? Yeah.
Genius.
So you had mentioned you've been here for about a year and a half.
A year and a half. We've been living here in this house.
Yeah. How long have when did you start like tracking other artists?
Oh, sorry, I hit your guitar there. No, not yours, Leander. I'm holding yours with respect. I don't respect Metropolis's guitar.
It's okay. Mine's not as good.
I started tracking people. So I went to CRAS, the mm-hmm. audio engineering school out here in the Valley.
Yeah.
And then I got out and did an internship for 3 months, and that was 2017. So I started working in 2018, but didn't start doing it full-time until 2019. So I guess it's been 2 years now I've been doing it full time. So
still
here I've been tracking people for since I moved in a year and a half ago, but before that I would just record at my apartment, and then I also freelance at Premiere Studios in Phoenix, so that's like a legitimate studio space, but it costs more money, so it's like better for people that are looking to do like bigger projects or like drums is something I can't really do here. Like I can, but it's kind of crude. So I prefer to do like cleaner drums there, and then we can do like acoustic guitar here or vocals here, you know, that sort of thing.
Gotcha.
But yeah, it's just like whatever works for each project.
So basically you can't do the drums, or it's not ideal here for the drums just because of the acoustics?
Yeah,
of the room?
Yeah, particularly the acoustics. It's a really square room. It's not treated for drums. It sounds really live and boomy. So when I record drums in here, I can get them to sound pretty good. Usually if I do them in my room, it's a little smaller and I can kind of bring some of these panels in there and kind of deaden it and make it sound different than it is.
Mm-hmm.
But for the most part, it comes out like, you know, it's like, okay, this could be better. This sounds like a good demo, you know, or like,
yeah.
So most of the time when I tell bands like, hey, if you want to do drums, we can do a demo here. Or if you're happy with like a lo-fi sound, then that works here at the house. But, if they're looking for some more high fidelity, like radio, you know, it's got to be at the studio because that's just, it's going to be so much easier to get done there, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
Yeah. That's what, we're almost at that stage.
Yeah, yeah. And we've kind of just been like here doing like acoustic stuff. So it's been really easy. We could do guitar here, you know, little things. Yeah. But we're getting to the point where now we're like, okay, we need to get some drums, you know, laid down. And that's going to be at the studio. Hopefully
at Premiere.
Yeah, at Premiere. That or another one. There's a few other places in town too that I can kind of freelance out of. Gotcha. So it just kind of depends on the project. I mostly work at Premiere because that's like that's where I interned at, so they know me there, and it's easy for me to just get a gig.
Gotcha.
But I could really just call around and see like, hey, this room is better for drums on this project, then I'll call them and say, hey, what's your rate for me to work there? And they'll hit say like, hey, I'll rent the room to you for like this much, you know, and then I just do that and then charge a little more to get paid.
Of course.
Yeah. Yeah. So depends. Guess we'll see, you know.
Yeah. How long has Premiere been around?
Ooh. Probably the better part of 5 years.
Okay.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they double as rehearsal space too. Okay. So they have like bands practice there in the little rooms, and you can rent them for like $15 an hour.
That's not bad. 15.
It's not bad. Yeah, 15. Mm-hmm. I think it might have gone up since the pandemic though, because they weren't doing too well.
Yeah, it makes sense.
But yeah, they've been around for about 5 years now. I interned for Jeremy Parker. He's an engineer. He's like the main guy there.
Mm-hmm.
He did all the Evanescence records in the early 2000s.
Okay. Okay.
Mudvayne, that sort of stuff. So it's like sort of like early 2000s rock hits. He was like the guy. So I interned for him, and he still works there. He thought I was good enough as an intern to let me work there. So now I get to work there. So it's kind of cool.
Yeah.
If you need a place to practice as a band, go to Premiere.
Where's it located?
It's on, 7th and Indian School around there out in Phoenix, downtown Phoenix.
Do you allow like certain bands to rehearse here?
Not particularly, just our band for the most part. I mean, like if you're good buddies, like Metropolis will come over and jam with his band. That's cool, you know.
Yeah.
Because then we can all jam, you know. It's like, hey, we don't have a drummer today. Can you just fill in? It's like, yeah, I can jam on the drums for a couple hours or something.
I throw a big beat down.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But yeah, for the most part, it'd be kind of a nightmare if we were just like renting it to random bands. Like, hey, please use all of our cool shit. You know, that would be kind of, that would
use our ridiculously antique drums that we've just restored.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's like, yeah, please don't break this. This is, worth more than your life here.
Yeah.
So where are you from, Josiah?
I am, well, that's a loaded question here. Like, do you want to know where I was born or where I'm from? Because those are two different things.
Where did you fall out of your mom's
uterus? Okay, I fell out of my mom in San Dimas, California.
San Dimas, okay.
And I lived there for 4 years, so I don't recollect much of that time, you know, very young. And then I moved to Yuma, Arizona, which is a border town down here in Arizona. Real corner.
Don't you have family
in Yuma? I'm from Welton.
Nice. Okay, cool. Yeah. So that area, very familiar. And then I spent most of my life there, moved out here when I was 19, I think, 18 or 19.
Yeah, same. Right out of high school, I moved up here.
Yeah, exactly.
What high school did you go to?
I went to Cibola High School.
Cibola. So what year did you graduate then?
I graduated in 2014. So kind of funny story, I actually graduated a year early.
Okay.
So I was supposed to graduate in 2015, but this is kind of funny. It's a long story. All right, I hope I'm not taking too much time on my personal life here. So in my sophomore year of high school, I was in jazz band playing guitar, and there was a I was hanging out with this girl. I was seeing this girl, you know, in the same class.
Yeah.
We were just like hanging out, you know. And so we went to the bathrooms because we wanted to light some shit on fire. We were just like angsty teenagers.
Yeah.
So we burned a CD and like the casing and everything inside. And then it was like, oh shit, I gotta go. The bell rang. I gotta go home. And we just like, one of us was supposed to throw it away, I think, and then one of us didn't. One of us left it there, and then we get called into the office the next day, and they were like, hey, like, this is, like, basic, like, we don't know how this is bad, but, you know, that's basically arson, I guess, you know? So they were like, you gotta go, you're done, like, you're suspended for the semester. And it was like, oh, shit, okay, well, whatever. So out in Yuma, they had, like, two options at the time with the school district. It was like, okay, you go to the trouble kid school, you know, finish out your semester. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, over there. And so it was like, you go there and you finish out your semester, or there's this new online thing. So you take all your classes online, you pay like a $20 fee per class. Mm-hmm. And it's like, cool. I was working at the time. So it was like, fuck it, I'll just do it online. So I did. And okay, anyone that's going to high school right now, like, if you have the option to do it online, just do it online, because you'll get it done so much faster.
Really?
There's so much bullshit that you do. Like, yeah. I was able to finish my sophomore year of high school within like 2 months of that semester, and I had like 3 months left. And so they were like, do you want to take all your junior year classes? And I was like, fuck yeah, I'll do that. So I finished my entire junior year like throughout the summer. And then by the time I came back in the fall, it was senior year. I was ready to go. I had all my credits for one last year.
Yeah.
So I did high school in 3 years instead of four.
So when you came back, like, all the kids that were in your grade were now in the grade below.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, man.
I know.
And you came back as the dude that almost set the school on fire.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, how the fuck did you do that?
Yeah, it was super funny because it was just like, hey, we thought you were going to be fucked up for life now, you know?
Now you're
like,
ahead of us?
And you're ahead of us now? Yeah. And it was like, yeah, I made the best out of a bad situation. And honestly, I don't regret it. It was like the best thing that could have happened to me, because I had so much time to myself at the time, because I was able to just kind of like do school. And then just like, at the time, I was really getting into writing music. That was like, I was really young and learning a lot of music theory and just like really being absorbed by it. So at the time, it was like so liberating to just have a bunch of time. Like, my mom was obviously like, hey, you can't go anywhere, you know, you got to stay home, you kind of got fucked up at school, you know. Like, you're kind of grounded for like 6 months. And it's like, okay, that's fair, you know. But then it was like, cool, I just get to be holed up in my room and learn a bunch of music for 6 months, which is pretty cool. So it kind of, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for that, really. It's kind of crazy.
So question is, which Nickelback CD did you set on fire?
It was actually a Black Veil Brides CD, if you guys know that band.
Oh, I've heard of them.
Yeah, they're just like a shitty, like,
My Chemical Romance type
band? Yeah, kind of. Okay, so MCR gets a lot of grief, but they're kind of cool. They're like, I don't know, like a weird, like, heavy metal, like, you know, like slanted hair sort of deal. Yeah. And so me and this other girl didn't like the band, so we were like, fuck this CD, you know.
But it worked out.
It worked out great.
Wait, no,
man.
But what happened to her though?
Yeah, did she
No, she's doing great. Yeah, I still keep in touch with her. She's dating a good buddy of mine. They live somewhere out in Chandler, I think.
Okay.
She's doing great. Yeah, she's good. Like, she works at a vet still. She's like a veterinary technician or something like that. She works with animals and she loves it, so it's cool. Go. She's good at it.
4-H is huge in Yuma, right?
Oh, hell yeah, dude. It's big. The fair. You go to the fair and people are like winning ribbons left and right for their horse that they've raised for 16 years or something crazy. What? You know what I mean? Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, they've been...
There's a fair down there? I didn't even know that.
It's Yuma small. It's like the size of our house. It's little. They've got like one Ferris wheel, you know?
One Ferris wheel and one duck, dude.
That's right.
One duck going
That's
around.
It. One little lonely duck. And then maybe the teacup ride if it works that year, but if it doesn't work, it's not coming. And that's it, you know?
I had a pig.
I heard a duck in here not too long ago. Didn't you, Lee? Didn't you hear that duck over here?
Quark. It was a barking spider. So what made you go to Crass then?
I was like into music and I started playing in bands and the whole nine yards. And then after that, I was in a band for a while and I was like hoping to kind of, you know, start getting things going. But then I realized it was like, yeah, well, this isn't really going to go anywhere. Like, I realized all the members kind of had other things going on and, you know, people moved away, that sort of thing. And it was like, okay, well, what do I do? I want to do music. That's what I want to do for a living. But I don't know, like, what's a safe bet? You know, playing in a band's like tough, you know, you have to find the right guys and then you have to really work hard to get it done. So it was like, okay, well, what can I do in the meantime while I'm waiting to meet those guys or something? And it was like, okay, well, I could go and learn how to record music and like learn how to work with bands because that sounds super fun. Plus, I just love learning about geeky shit. So like learning how to use gear was like super fascinating to me.
Yeah.
So a buddy of mine went and he told me it was totally worth it. So I said, fuck it, let's go. You know, I want to move out of Yuma. I'm done being here. I don't want to be there anymore. So I moved out here and decided to go. Met a lot of great people. And now I do it for work, so it was worth it.
Damn, that's it, man. Set up.
Mm-hmm.
Get referrals.
Oh yeah, no, exactly. Yeah. And that's exactly how it worked. It was kind of funny. I was working a regular full time job for a long time, and I was doing it on the side, but it was tough. And I realized, like, okay, at some point, I just have to kind of decide, like, it's got to be one or the other, because I'm never gonna do this successfully if I don't just stop doing the other thing, you know. Mm-hmm. So then it was like, all right, well, I just got to take a leap of faith and just go out there and like force yourself. Because when the fire is lit, it's like, you have to pay rent this month. How are you going to do it? Right. It's like, okay, well, you got to go to a show. You got to meet somebody. You got to convince them that you're good at what you do. And then you got to do a good job, you know, and then just keep doing that and like scrounge up whatever money you can, live on small food here and there, you know, whatever you can do. Yeah. And then eventually word of mouth is like killer for me. For a long time, I was like, shit, I have to start like an Instagram page and a Facebook page and like get it going. And that does help, but for like 90% of my work is all word of mouth. So it's like, I work with somebody and they just hey, my buddy needs someone to record this. And it's like, oh, cool, I can do that. And then, you know, most of the time they'll hit me up and sometimes they won't, you know, or later they'll hit me up at an unexpected time when it's like, I'm slow and I'm like, oh shit, I need work, you know? And then boom, I get a text like, hey, I'm so-and-so's buddy. And like, that's kind of what happened with Chopless. I was in a slow period and I didn't have much work. And then it was like, hey, I'm Jared's buddy. I was hoping to get some work in. And I was like, heck yeah, let's do it. So then I've been working ever since.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
Yeah. It's good stuff.
Dope. When are you expecting the album you guys are working on right now to drop?
Ooh, well, that depends, you know? Oh, you mean my band or his band?
Oh, yours.
Oh. That, so we are still recording it. It's not mixed or mastered or anything. So sometime this year, for sure, sometime this year. But we want to do, we want to get the record done and then artwork and all that jazz. And then get like a good PR campaign going, get some push behind it, you know, get some singles out, put a video out, and then drop the record. And so probably a few months from now.
Who do you send your stuff to get mixed and then mastered by?
So it depends. So like, the last record we did, I recorded everything myself at Premiere.
Yeah.
But I decided that I didn't want to mix it because it's tough. When I'm mixing, whenever I hear a band that's like, oh yeah, I did everything. I mixed a mess. I'm like, that's really cool. I'm glad you did that. But there's a certain level of like objectivity that gets lost there, you know? Because like, at least the way I work, I like to work really objectively. And it's nice working on other people's music because there's no, like, I can be kind of attached to it, but it's like I can just make objective decisions, like this sounds good, this doesn't sound good.
Exactly.
But when I'm playing in the band, it's different, because it's like, well, you know, are all my mixes going to be guitar heavy because I'm the guitar player, you know what I mean? Or are they going to favor one thing because I just like the way that sounds? And I don't want it to be that way. I want it to be like what's best for the song. And
yeah,
so
for sure.
I decided to record the last one because I figured that's a safe bet. I can do that and someone else can mix it. So last time we had a guy out in LA, his name is Wyatt Blair. He mixed our record. And then this time around, we're going a different route because... Yeah, that's my cat Felix. He wants to be in the podcast.
Felix the cat.
Yeah, Felix the cat. That's right. This time around we went a different route because the last time we recorded, it was tough because we had to kind of do the classic, like, okay, drums first and then the bass and then the guitar and then the vocal, like kind of multi-track one thing at a time.
Mm-hmm.
And this time around we didn't want to do that because it was like we lose a certain level of like connectedness when it comes to that. So I couldn't be doing two things. I had to kind of like decide, like, okay, I'm just not gonna do anything this time around, because then I can just focus on like working on the music instead of like, oh, I gotta make sure this mic's right, or like I gotta make sure that this is working, or like levels are good, you know.
Yeah,
so it's tough to kind of split your brain that way, and I hats off to anyone who can do it. That's really cool. It's just not for me. So I decided to go with a guy. His name is Josh Medina. He works out here in Tempe, and we decided to kind of track live, semi-live, you know. So we went in and cut the drums and the bass live, just the three of us playing, and like did a few takes and cut them together. And now I'm going and overdubbing guitar, and then we're going to overdub vocals and everything else after that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it kind of just depends. I didn't really have like a plan on like, we're always going to go to this person. It was just kind of like whatever sounds best for the record. So when we were writing these songs, it was like, well, these are a little more raw. We really have to capture that sort of like connectedness of the band unit this time around. So
I think that's something that is kind of getting lost, is like the, it's got to be perfect. It's got to be on time. What's the, like, synchronized?
Quantized,
yeah. I think you lose a lot of like the authenticity.
Yeah,
of it.
It makes it kind of stale at times. And it depends on the style of music though. Yeah. You know, like mine and Alex's buddy Raquel from that band Panic Baby, she does like pop music. So that's like her thing. So when I'm working on production for her, it's very much like, okay, this has got to be like 100% to the degree, because the vocals are the main thing. So everything else has to be like not troublesome at all whatsoever. And that works for that style of music. But then when I'm working with Alex here, it's like, okay, you know, we're just going to cut this acoustic guitar with no click track, and then we're going to see what happens, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And then we're going to overdub on top of that. And sometimes that gives us trouble, but it's like, it's kind of worth it, because it gives you that fluidity of like where the song goes naturally, as opposed to it being like everything chopped up sort of deal, you know?
Yeah, it gives it more of that live feeling, especially with music like this.
Yeah, exactly. You know? Yeah, it all comes down to the style of music, you know. Because if it's like, oh, okay, pop music wasn't meant to be played live, you know, it was always meant to be like done in the studio on a laptop, you know, like that's where it's best. But like rock music is just like, you gotta play in a room together and just jam, you know.
Yeah, you shouldn't go to the same show and see the same show.
Exactly. Like, yeah. And some people like that, but you know, it's not for me.
Yeah, and that's a good point you make about like not doing everything yourself, where it allows you to just channel the instrument instead of focusing on like I gotta nail it. That actually brings me back to my mushroom trip. My mushroom trip I was having, and I'm like, oh my God, that's awesome. I can't wait to talk about that on my podcast. And then it would bring me back to like the voice would be like, shut the fuck up and just enjoy, take in the moment.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay. And then another idea would come. And it's like, oh my God, I can't wait to like, talk about that. And then it's like, shut up and just be in the moment. So, so you leaving the mixing to somebody else allows you to just be the instrument.
Yeah. And I still get to have like a good hands-on sort of thing. Cause it's like being an engineer allows me to communicate to the guy working on it in a way that like some musicians couldn't. So if it's like I have specific things in mind, I can tell them like, okay, use these things, like, or use these settings or whatever. Like, this is the sound I'm going for. And it's like, boom, it clicks so much faster. Because like on a technical level, I can tell them like, hey, use this piece of gear because I know what this sounds like. I like the way this sounds. And they, if they have it, they're like, oh yeah, that sounds great. Cool, I'll do that. And they set it exactly how I want it.
And there's some confidence in that because that allows you to execute, I think, better knowing that you know how to communicate exactly what you're expecting them to do.
Exactly.
So now you can just kind of lean in instead of just being like, I hope they're getting it.
Yeah, exactly. So it's kind of like, it's like you have to meet in the middle a little bit instead of like,
it's a dance.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a tangle. But,
you know, and it's different for everybody because like the people that I work with also, they kind of just like to be like, dude, just make like, this is how it sounds. Make it sound good, you know? And it's like, cool. And then I just kind of do what sounds good to me.
Yeah.
And most of the time, if they're vibing with it, then it's going to sound good, you know? But if they're not vibing, then all I have to do is change it, you know? The smallest bit, like find out what's wrong with it and then change it to get what they're wanting out of it, you know? And as long as you can do that every time, it's like, you're always going to be hitting the mark. As long as you're making sure that everyone in the room thinks it sounds good. Because if there's somebody that's like, eh, no, that doesn't sound too good, then you got a problem. And you can't be like stubborn. You can't be like, no, I think this sounds good.
Yeah, because it's just going to come back in 4 weeks.
Exactly. And yeah. It's just like, no, dude, okay, if they don't think this sounds good, put your ego aside for a sec and say like, okay, they don't think this sounds good. What can I do to fix that? You know, like I want it to sound awesome to them. And it's nice having that sort of ability to not have to worry about that with my own music because I'm like, okay, I know the part I wrote sounds good to me, but now I don't have to worry about it sounding good to someone else because this guy's taking care of that, you know? And that's super liberating because then I can be creative in other ways that I wouldn't be able to if I was like really hands-on recording it, you know? Yeah, it's cool. It's cool.
It's like trying to multitask.
Yeah. Yeah, it can get a little daunting, especially if the music is really involved. And our music isn't like super involved, but it's funny because we play like rock music, but I really strive for perfection a little bit too much at times for myself. So it's easy for me to like, if I was doing it myself, I'd do a million takes of a guitar solo until it sounded perfect. But it's like so much better for me to play it 3 times and the guy's like, oh, that one was great. And it's like, okay, cool. If he thinks it's great, if I duped that guy into thinking it's great, then I'm going to dupe anyone into thinking that's great. You know, and then I'm not worried about it. And then I can move on. And I don't get stuck in a sort of like loop of like, man, I've been doing this guitar solo for like 3 hours now, you know? Yeah. And it's like, I don't even want to play it. I'm not even inspired by this guitar solo anymore because I've been playing it for so long. So, but then once I can move on, it's just like everything's kind of building step by step, you know? There's no looking back. It's just like, boom, that's done. That's in. That is done. I'm not doing that again.
Yeah.
And then you just move on.
Yeah, because you can over perfect the good qualities out of something.
Yeah, exactly. And even if you had something note for note perfect, it's like, yeah, you could listen back and be like, and just remember, man, I hated that solo because I just felt bad playing it. Even though it sounds perfect, you just be like, the feeling I had associated with playing that wasn't good. So then you're like, this guitar solo sucks, you know? And to someone else, it's like, oh, it's great. But then to you, it's like, you know, it was all right. It didn't feel that great. Or you don't like playing it anymore. Or the song, you're like, the song's okay. You know, you just kind of fall out of love with stuff. So you have to kind of like almost be like hitting the ground running at all times. Just like chasing that feeling of like, okay, creative spark, run with it. And then don't look back. And then like definitely make sure you're doing your due diligence, you know, along the way. But like don't spend too much time in one place. Otherwise you get stuck. Kind of just doing the same things or fucking up or doing something that's, you know, overly perfect, and it's like you're criticizing things that aren't even there, or, you know, just getting stuck. That's all.
Yeah, and then you're almost looking for something to find that's not good.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, like and you can always do that. You can always find something that's not good. But it's so much easier to just kind of like accept what is there and move on, you know? So.
Especially in this band, there's always something that's not
good. No, dude, Alex always brings great songs to me. I'm always excited to work on this stuff because it's always something fresh, you know? Like, he's got a sound, but it's very much like, oh, that's just Alex, you know? It's not like, hey, that reminds me of this band or this reminds me of this band. Like, I can hear influences, but it's never like, oh, I've heard this before or like, oh, okay, this song again, you know? It's always like, cool, I'm excited to see where this goes or, you know, it's cool to see it build too, because sometimes we'll just get like guitar work done for like a verse and a chorus, and then next time we have a session, it's like, oh, dude, I wrote a bridge, or help me write this bridge, and I'll help him write a bridge. Yeah. And then it's like, okay, cool. And then you see it build again, and it's like, hey, I got lyrics for this verse, or I got lyrics for the whole song, done. Mm-hmm. And then, boom, we cut the vocals. Yeah. And it's like, cool, this is great. And then you see it at the end, and it's like, okay, this is the finished product now. And it's cool to kind of look back and see, like, where it started and, like, where it ended up. So... Yeah.
That's kind of what we did for that Thirsty Land.
Yeah,
song.
Yeah.
I kind of came into Josiah with just like the bare bones of it.
Yeah, it was like a jam, like a voice memo on his phone. He was just like, yeah, this is a jam thing, I think, you know, this could be kind of jammy. Mm-hmm. And I was like, okay, cool, let's make it a song, you know, and then we were just kind of like jamming two acoustic guitars and just like, okay, yeah, that's cool. Or, no, that's not cool. And then just laying down a demo and then going back and re-recording it and recording it again. And then finally, you know, kind of takes shape over time. It's like building a house or something, you know.
Yeah.
Like one piece at a time. It's kind of cool.
We gotta build a little neighborhood here.
Yeah, we're trying to build a neighborhood with the album here.
Do you almost feel like you cheat when you have those moments where it just comes to you, where everything just comes to you, and you're like you're leaving something on the table, or like there's like, no, there's something that has to be wrong with this.
No.
When you just channel like the ether.
I think those moments happen more often now because I don't think about them. Like most of the time, if I'm working with anybody, it's always like, okay. And they need help. So they're like, hey, I need help writing this thing. Or like, this isn't quite working. Or like, what would you do here? 90% of the time, it's just like, cool. I just analyze what they're doing. Like, what's the key of the song? Where are we going? What's the vibe? And then, boom, usually the first thing that comes to my mind, it's not always the thing that ends up making it, but it's always the most inspired thing. I find the first thing that I come up with always the most inspired. So usually, whether it's the thing we keep or it inspires something else, right. You know? Mm-hmm. So like, boom, just like first thought. Don't even think about it too hard. Just first thing that comes out. And it's either going to be like, oh, that's great. Or it's going to be like, nah, not quite that. And then you have somewhere to start. You have a starting point. Like, okay. Even if it is that, you're like, cool, it's that, I can move on. But if it's not, you're like, okay, it's not that. But now I know what it's not. You know, I know it can't be that. It'll never be that, so I shouldn't try that again. Mm-hmm. And then I know, like, cool, I can roll that out and then move on to the next thing. And I feel like once you do that, it's like, then they'll always come to you. Because as long as you're letting them come to you, you're never not going to find the idea. You know, and it's always different with your own music. But most of the time, if it's just kind of like, let's finish this. There's a deadline. It's like, cool, I want to finish this verse by next week. It's like, cool, easy. Let's just like buckle down and figure out what we want to do for it, you know, not think about it too hard. And most of the time it ends up being great because it's just like, cool, we totally felt that out. It was a vibe thing more than it was like a technical thing, you know?
Yeah.
And it's always a little bit of both. It's like, you really have to think about the technicalities, but not so much so that you're like analyzing it like Bach or Mozart or something, you know. You're
or
not
too
like
robotic.
Exactly. Yeah. You're not like, okay, this is an ostinato piece here and it's a mezzo forte here and then we're gonna crescendo here. You know, it's like, okay, we're just gonna like play and feel
I don't know
it out.
Any of those words
crescendo sound again.
Yeah.
I heard that.
Yeah.
So it's different with each song. But I would say working with Alex is probably like the most like roller coastery, but in a good way, like a good feeling roller coaster, you know, like it's great. Yeah,
some days we got nothing, some days
sometimes I'll just sit out in the backyard with Alex while he smokes joints and writes lyrics, and it's like, hey, what is this? Does this line sound good? Or like, yeah, it's cool. Or we'll just go out there and listen to demos, and it's like, cool, that's the whole day. But it's totally worth it because it's like, cool, now we know what we're doing and like got the vibe, or like, let's hone in on these things, or let's work on these ideas. And then next time we've got a game plan. Like, okay, cool, boom. I'm inspired by this demo. Let's just jump on it now while I have the inspiration. And it's cool because then every time it's always productive, but in a way that's like creatively productive, as opposed to it being like, okay, this is work. You know, clock in, play the guitar part. You know, it's like, okay, cool, we're gonna clock in, but we're gonna kind of just see what happens here. You know, we're gonna kind of go with the flow. And that's a cool way to work. I like it. You know, and I feel like now we're like working on basically two records at once, you know, almost, it feels like.
Yeah,
because we have like so many ideas on my whiteboard. It's like, cool, these will be for the first EP, but then like Alex is already bringing me ideas for the second one or like the next record, you know, and like this is a single for the other one. And it's like, cool, okay, yeah. And you should never fight that. You should never be like, okay, no, let's stay out, because then like you're just missing out on opportunities to create more music, and mm-hmm. you should never do mm-hmm. that, you know?
Right.
Because then, like, say this second record gets done before the first one. It's like, cool. Well, that one's just done, and we don't have to worry about that one.
Yeah.
You know? The first one will come when it comes, you know? But
I could also probably do a better job of, like, finishing where I started with the first ones, huh?
No, we're getting close. See, that's the thing is, like, it's easy to kind of, like, when you're inspired, like, fall into, like, the, okay, this is where we're doing another idea here. But then, like, you always come back to, like, okay, well, we do got to finish the first album. And then you find inspiration, like, because they're so fresh, you haven't touched them in a while. It's like, oh, Thirsty Land, that's right, we got to finish that. Like, yeah. Let's go back to that, and let's play, let's have Lee cut a guitar solo. And it was like, we did that, like, 2 weeks ago?
Maybe like a month ago.
Yeah. So, like, that was, like, the last thing we added to mm-hmm. the track was Lee's guitar solo. And it was like, when we were going back listening to it, I was thinking, like, oh, this is fresh, I haven't heard this in so long. And yeah. then you hear the guitar solo and it's like, cool, I'm like even more inspired by this song now, because it's yeah. like fresh again and there's a new thing on it, you know.
Yeah. So it's good, cool. like letting it rest
yeah.
and over there, and then you focus on another task, and when you come back, it's not like
yeah.
it's not like beating one yeah. project
exactly
till yeah. you're till it's dull.
Yeah, a lot of people like to focus on one song, and that's cool, you know, like really just drive all their energy to finishing that one song and then the next one. But working this way, I think, just works better for creativity's sake, mm-hmm, especially mm-hmm. when it's like we're starting from nothing, or like starting from a small thing, like a voice memo, and then moving into a song. Yeah, yeah, I think it works out pretty well.
Yeah, we're just over here doing what we can, you know.
Leander, could you do me a favor? Could you hand me that water that's right there by your feet?
Look at that.
Oh, thank you.
Bang bang.
Thank
you. Got the old reusable straw and everything.
And my water's empty. This was a mistake. I grabbed my water and it's empty.
It's empty. Did you want to play a little something? Play us out?
Me? Oh, no. I'm not in that. Metropolis, man. I can't play. But we can bring Leander back and he can play with Metropolis here.
Well, I don't really know what else we would play. What else? I don't even... What should we play? I can do...
Play your ringtone, Leander. Bing bong, bing bong, bing, bing bong, bing bong, bing.
How about you just fiddle then while I carry us out?
Okay, sounds good. Or give me a key, Mr. Metropolis.
Let's go in G here.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, this has been the latest installment of This One Time. It's a podcast focused on interviewing intelligent, diverse, and interesting individuals. We hope you have gained a better understanding on some various perspectives you might have not had otherwise. We hope you have been inspired to follow your own passions.
Yes.
From these gentlemen.
Follow your passions.
Following theirs. Allow the gentle strums of these acoustic emotional conduits lead you to greener pastures. Guys, Leander, Josiah, Alex, thanks for coming on, guys.
You guys need someone to introduce you. Everybody give it up for This One Time.
Just This One Time. This has been This One Time, and until next time, I love you, we love you. Do you love us?
Yeah. That's the question.
All right, guys. Adios.
Easy enough.